fifth. So yes, lots of cars battling here at the top of the circuit.
Actually one car that's not in this battle, I believe, and that is the 60, is that the 60?
Yeah, it's the 60 car that isn't in this battle, the Trinity Motorsports car, but is still looking to unwrap himself, perhaps trying to get past the Han Endurance team. That's the second blue BMW in this pack, the one just behind the light blue Han Endurance car. He's pulling over to the left hand, letting the Iberica Racing Team car through as they go into the source.
Yeah, we have to remember Iberica's on fresh tires, so they're probably going to blow by most of these cars here.
Yeah, good point. Yeah, they're seven laps. Nope. How many laps on him? They are one lap into their stint, or two laps into their stint, in fact.
Yeah, fresh tires are going to be a lot here, so they'll probably catch up quite a bit.
Relative lap time, previous lap was 2:19, whereas the cars ahead were 2:24, so yes, 5 seconds a lap faster. And ahead of him, in fact, the Ham Racing car has just got past the Cracks Racing car for P22, and now Cecilia is right up behind them both, looking to pass. And now he's going up the inside into the right-hander at Bruchel, and has managed to pass that Cracks Racing car, and almost had enough grip to pass the Ham Racing car, which was a gap. But I think we'll see him go past very quickly. These fresh tyres working wonders. Obviously, they are a little out of sync, though, in terms of pit strategy.
Yeah, this is definitely... Oh, Ham Endurance team... I don't know why they're defending here. They're just losing time, to be honest. The 10 car has way fresher tires and should just be able to go right by.
Yeah, they might not be aware of that, I guess. But, maybe their spotter will let them know, but it's sort of, there's so much going on, it's hard to know who's doing what. Especially if you're focusing on your own race. But I think he's going to go through here, just so much more traction on the way out. Oof. Around the outside. Still on the outside from Blanchimont, and that move is done, and the Ham Endurance car has to brake in the middle of Blanchimont, and Cedric Finsac of Cracks Racing now has a chance in that blue BMW, and behind them is the Vortex car also having a look around the outside of the chicane, and I think he's going to do it, it's Finsac, and he's managed to take that 22nd position. Or has he? No, the Ham Endurance McLaren is on the inside for the source, and down the inside of both of them, the Vortex car, there's not room for that, and he's done it, he's passed them both. John Grizz, amazing move, absolutely brilliant.
We have to remember, he's still driving, and he has a pit stop coming up here soon. He's been driving the first 3 hours of the race, surely, you know, he's getting tired.
Ooh, oh, big crash! Oh no! That is a disaster. He just made a fantastic move and has just wrecked the car. That is a huge shame. That's a fast tow back to the pit lane. Goodness me, lost it on his own. He had a little bit,
actually,
carried some too much speed into the upper part of Eau Rouge.
If he's lucky enough to still have a fast tow, that right there, it's going to tow him to the pit, so it's going to take time to get around to the pit lane. But then once he gets there, maybe his car's going to be repaired, but I don't know. I don't know if they've been used up. I know one has been used up because he did have damage earlier.
Yeah, so. He had just made a pass for, what was that? I think it was 22nd. He just managed to, because he passed those two cars. Yeah, I know he was 21st. He would have been 21st. And he was briefly 21st. He was upside down. Big shame. Imagine they'll probably go for a driver swap after that. Assuming that that's in their schedule.
Remember earlier we were talking about Coando or catching Team TTL? Well, they've caught him. for viewers out there, you just saw Coanda get around. TTL not putting up much of a fight.
So that's Coanda now into 8th. And they will eventually probably take the lead briefly because of their out of syncness.
Want to note that Team Redline are currently in the pits.
Yeah, that puts NX Racing Red into the lead, 1.7 seconds ahead of GT Ross SST Silver. But of course, they're yet to pit.
Yeah, interesting to note here. Remember that GT Ross was right behind NX Racing Red before the last set of pit stops. Now they finally have caught them. However, pit stops are going to happen once again. I say they've caught them, they're actually in the middle of traffic here.
Yeah, that's sort of
maybe that's why they caught them so easily.
Yeah, I think that explains it, yeah.
It's actually going to be tough for Alvaro to get around. Because we are now joined by Yanni Hagner, Glacier Racing Team.
Yeah, hello.
So we've been enjoying the race so far. You've had a really... a really exciting race up in the top 10. You were up in 5th for a while there, so I guess the changes made to the 4GT have really helped you quite a bit, and obviously you guys are quick racers, and I think you finally can be competitive in this car.
Yeah, well, at least 45 kilos helps a lot, but also the change in the rear diff will make the car harder to go to corners, but well, you cannot get everything once.
I think it's a step in the right direction for the car for sure. It still probably needs a little bit more though.
Yeah, if they will make the if gains back, it would be quite near, and like 5-10 kilos more is okay.
Have you been in the car yet, or are you waiting to drive?
I'm waiting to drive still, but we let Yari drive like 3 hours now. This should be his last hit, and let him get good sleep.
Okay, and he had a slight collision with Core Racing, Core Motorsports, earlier in the race. Is there any damage from that, or is the car okay?
Well, it's just got damage from the Turkish car for the pass from the bus stop.
Okay. And are you guys how many drivers have you got on your roster for this race? And do you know who's driving when, or are you just sort of improvising?
We have like 5 cars dudes driving. Backman is on reserve still, but I think he can get to competitive pace during the night if he wants. And I think we will get him to drive in the morning or something.
Do you reckon? I mean, I guess it's still a long way to go in this race, but are you targeting a top 10 finish for this one?
Well, let's hope so. The 5 would be even better.
Yeah, it's definitely possible. Yeah, you guys were right up there. Yeah, it should be fun. And I think you have, I guess, not too many problems so far, which is good, because other people have had, you know, incidents. You've had, it's been a relatively clean race, which I guess...
Yeah,
it's helpful.
Yeah, it's helpful. And usually our drivers don't make big mistakes, which is good for our endurance racing. And well, Lohtar is now driving. He's not the fastest of us, but he's doing pretty decent job. And he's saving fuel now, so looking very good.
Great. Have you got any websites or sponsors or anything that you want to mention before you go?
Well, I think I'm not sure, but I think Riku will be streaming his stints during the night. So Twitch plus Atulu. And join there.
Cool.
We'll be sure to give that a mention later.
I think Latari just made a pass around the outside at the bus stop, just past Brad Wootton in direct clutch for 23rd position, so another overtake there. Yeah, thank you, Yoni Hacker, from Glacier Racing, for coming to talk to us, and have a good rest of your race.
Yep, have fun.
So that pass there, Latari, who'd been in the pits. When's he last been in the pits? Let me have a look. 3 laps, yeah, so he's 3 laps into his stint, so yeah, he's got very much fresher tyres than the direct clutch car of Brad Wootton, who he just passed, so that explains the ease at which he was able to do that.
Also want to note that we have a situation brewing which potentially will be for the lead. Team Redline and NX Racing Red are both pit. Jake Sturgis back in the car for NX Racing Red. Alexei Yusi-Jakola still in the car for Team Redline. It's about a 2 second gap now. So as you can see, that's closed dramatically from what it was before.
Yeah, Jake Sturgis back in the car for NX Racing Red, and he's one of the faster guys in that team. So it'll be and the last time that he was in the car at the same time as Jakola was a couple of stints ago, and he was consistently quicker, and now he's not far away. So yes, this will be a battle for the lead eventually once Commander SimSport pits in about half an hour or so.
Yes, GT Ross also, Coanda's not that far ahead actually, so they might catch them since Coanda will be on older tires. They might catch Coanda before Coanda actually enter the pits.
Yeah, there's only 2 seconds between them.
Exactly. So, also GT Ross have not pit. Both their cars actually have not pit. So they're currently covering the first and second positions.
So this is important now. With Jake Sturgis looking, I mean, he's going to be trying to take the lead in the next few laps. He just has to, as tempting as it is to, you know, get the advantage as soon as possible, with so much of the race still left, he needs to be super careful. Because taking the lead at this point, you know, it doesn't mean an awful lot. But on the other hand, maybe if he's got the pace, he wants to stretch his advantage on those at the start of his stint. So yeah, lots of thinking for him to do. I think he'll just, well, he's a cool head, I think. So I think he'll make the right choice.
Yeah, I think he'll see that there's still 20 hours left. So I believe he'll take his time, get around him, hopefully not lose too much time doing it. Who knows, though, it all matters really if Alecti wants him to go or if he wants to try to hold him off. But as you can see here, I mean, a lot of time's been gained this lap. And it's going to be even more because Jake now has the draft.
Yeah, so heading up towards the bus stop now.
We're about to see a supreme lap probably by Jake here.
So you're just joining us. You're just over 3 hours into the 24 hours of Spa Masters of Endurance. Brought to you by Blue Flag Racing. And you're looking at what is going to be the lead battle, the net lead battle, Team Redline with Alexei Yusi-Jakola at the wheel and Jake Sturgis at the wheel of the NX Racing Red BMW. And that lap from Jake Sturgis was the best lap of the race from NX Racing Red so far. On fresh tyres.
Fresh tyres, a little bit of draft, definitely a very quick lap by them.
Yeah, he was nearly a full second quicker than Yusi-Jakola on that lap.
Now Alexei also has the draft from Martin and a SimSport just ahead of him.
Yeah, and that Commander car, in case you just joined us, was up in second position before an incident, no fault of their own, a car in the middle of the track, caused them to have to pit and had a lot of damage to repair, and so they are in third at the moment, but are about half an hour sort of out of sync in terms of pit stops, so we won't know how well they're doing for a few hours yet, since if they get back into sync with everyone else. So yeah, they're currently third, and you know, they won't want to let the Redline car through too easily. That's Martin Kronker at the wheel. Then again, Kronker probably, you know, as you say, one of the best drivers in the field, probably know what the best decision is. sort of just let maybe just be nice and careful. And he's got a very, very gentle driving style again, lifting and coasting on the way in and out, on the way into corners.
It's kind of weird, actually. The top, or those three cars that you see there, are piloted by drivers that can finish top five in DWC. And, you know, in most cases, Martin actually went on a big winning spree at the end of last season, DWC. Jake's actually never won a race, however, he has finished second a couple times. And then also Alexei Yussi Jakola, who's, I believe, won at least one race. I know he won races in the Pro Series.
And that was a wide entry into the second part of Blanchimont from Jakola there. I thought he was going to clip the grass, but he got away with it. But yeah, now it's a three-car train, third, fourth, and fifth.
I'm curious to see what goes on here.
Yeah, because so up ahead of them is GT Ross Silver and GT Ross Orange. They are 16 seconds and then 1 minute 39 seconds ahead of this battle.
Yeah, GT Ross Orange is actually pit. They're in the pits right now, but Silver have not pit.
Yeah, so Silver 1.5 minutes ahead. They will fall behind once they've pitted. So this is now a battle for the lead.
Curious here, though, what will happen, because Coanda's slowly starting to drop in times, and they're pretty much in the same range as GT Ross Silver were. So,
Coanda pulling, Kronker sensibly pulling over, letting these two have their own battle.
Oh, that was incredibly nice by him.
Yep, it makes sense. He's saving fuel, trying to make the best of an unfortunate situation, and that was probably the best move to make. So that leaves it a clear one-on-one fight between Jake Sturgios and that BMW versus the McLaren, the Redline McLaren, of Alexei Yussi Jakola.
Curious how he's going to get past here. McLaren's a little bit faster in a straight line. However, it's a little weird since Kimmel Straight is uphill. I feel like the McLaren maybe doesn't have that speed going up the hill. Wing angle, means everything as well. So, we'll see exactly how the BMW, how much it can draft up.
So we're now just going into Stavelot and then up towards Blanchimont. Could be seeing a move into the bus stop. He's very close now, Sturgios.
This is a possibility for sure. Just want to note that GT Ross Silver have entered the pits.
So that'll see them take the lead as they come past the pit lane next time round. But who will it be in the lead? Well, Jake Sturgios backs off a little bit as Alexei just stays ahead as they go into the bus stop. Sturgios breaks at the same time as Yussi Jakola, and they maintain their position for now. And in fact, Yussi Jakola got a good run out of the bus stop there, so Sturgios is going to have to use that draft to great effect on the Kemmel Straight. And like you say, if the McLaren doesn't quite do as well going uphill, then we could be looking at a move into Le Coune.
GT Ross car hasn't started rolling yet either.
So now they officially take the lead now.
Yep.
The car pulls away.
GT Ross car just started taking off as well. Once again, it looks like this is very strange. GT Ross car gets really close to NX Racing Red. Then they have their pit stop, and now they've dropped back 8 seconds. So I'm guessing it takes a little bit longer for them to refuel completely, yet they are going a little bit further on their stints. And also the fresh tires play a big role as well.
Yeah, and also during this battle, they'll probably, I think Sergio's going to lose a fair amount of time as he battles with Team Redline. Oh, a little wobble through the middle of the shell there for Yussi Jakola. It was a minor thing, but nonetheless, a little bit of a moment. Now, as we head into the left, right and left-hander at Fannier, we're on board with Jake Sturgios, so we have a great view of his current problems, the flame licking out of the back of that McLaren. Now, championship-leading McLaren, don't forget.
Yeah, these are the top two in the championship, actually.
Yeah, this is important. 200 points at stake for a win. That's double what you would get for any other race in this championship. Now into Blanchimont. And he's got a great, great draft, but just couldn't find a way up the inside and lost a bit of time. Had to lift off going into the second element of that part of the track. And again, can't brake late enough for the bus stop. So another lap goes by with Jake Sturgios not being able to pass the Team Redline car. Drive through penalty for Car 10, Iberica Racing Team, for repeated corner cutting.
Yeah, we've actually been following that, and you know we've double checked every single time, and you know it's just been too many, and we've had to issue a penalty there for them.
Yeah, that, tracks. So they're in P5 on this. That is actually very significant. They've been up there for the whole race, but yeah, consistent corner cutting, you will get penalised.
Just want to note that this is also, it's for Blanchimont, is the corner that they've been, I don't want to say exploiting, but going off track too many times in.
Interesting. Can't say I've spotted that myself. I've been looking at them for quite a lot this race.
Yeah, we've been kind of lenient because we know about the lag and everything. So if it's a little close, we're trying to say, okay, you know, that's all right. But, you know, if you're going off track so many times, even if lag's involved, you got to understand that you can see when you get an off track. So, you know, you need to be more careful, essentially. It's just like Dylan Sharman said, you know they're Australian, they have high ping, and they're going to have to drive, you know, a little bit. They're going to have to cut a little bit of time, drive a little bit slower, but they need to make sure that they're not going to get a penalty. As
car
we see
ahead.
A car spun up.
Yeah, that was that Puan. That is the 92 car of High Revs Racing. Robert Jakubowski, I think that was.
Yeah, they're currently in the 52nd position.
I think they might have teleported back to pits, I'm not sure. But anyway, back with the lead battle. Still on board with Jake Sturgios. Another lap. He's been stuck behind Alexei Yusuf-Yakula for about four laps. The red line car is a bit wide.
He might be saving fuel, I'm not sure. But yeah, I think he wants to get around. I think he believes that he's quicker. It's just, how is he going to get that run? Alexi's very good through Blanchimont there.
Yep. Yeah, the main overtaking spots, Alexi does appear to have the... he's got the speed in the right places, basically.
Exactly. And that's probably the most frustrating thing ever for a car following.
And they're both lapping very quickly. Considering the fact they are in a battle, they're both lapping in the low 219s. Which is really impressive considering how close they are to each other.
Yeah, that last lap actually was an 18.7. You're going incredibly quick. They're the fastest two cars on track currently. GT Rolls, which has fresher tires, actually came out of the pits and did an 18.1. So they're doing a great job. And as you can see here, Jake's dropped back once again from Alexi and coming up to the Kimmel Straight, which is probably one of the most important passing zones of the racetrack.
Got a car up ahead. Scott Michaels, R4R Motorsport, in P16, next to be lapped. Ahead of him is Alexandre Seitano of AB Racing Silver, down in P43. So that's the next challenge that Alexei Yusuf-Yakula has, is to lap those two BMWs. You can see them both riding on board still with Jake Sturgios. Maybe Jake will use this as his opportunity.
That is true. Might lose some. Oh, Alexi's bobbled a little bit there.
Ooh, just go away with it. But I think into Fannier, he might have an opportunity if Alexi goes to the left, which he does. Will he break later? They're side by side into Fannier. And it's a wobble with both side by side. Alexi stays on the inside, red line maintains the lead, but Jake Sturgios has better traction coming out on the right. He's on the outside. Almost touch. And into the right-hander, and Sturgios takes the lead for NX Racing Red from Alexei Yusuf-Yakula, Team Redline. It took him a long time to do it, and it was a small mistake that was required to allow him to make that pass.
Yeah, now Jake has to go and cut this draft as best he can here. Alexei's going to have a great run through here. He actually does. He clips the grass just a little bit before corner entry. That's very strange.
Yeah, he's done that. He worries me every lap, but it seems to, and that's his way of driving, it seems. But I think, well, let's see what he does on the next couple of straights, and if he can make this position back, or if he's going to happily sit back in second and calmly drive to the end of the stint.
Calmly drive, I don't know about that. Still a 19-0 by Jake, even though that they were battling that whole time.
Alexei Yakovlev broke a bit of traction there coming out of La Source. The wheels spun up slightly on the exit.
Yeah, I think Jake's going to be safe here. He has a car coming out of the pits, as you can see on the right of the screen. But already past that. Just those couple lap cars that are still ahead. They're not really gaining that much time on them.
Yeah, I think that's job done.
Yep, and I think Jake needs to make sure he does consistent lap times now. Now that GT Roadster, it's just an 18.7 last lap, so they're back on it, and we'll see what happens here. They have a couple lap fresher tires.
So just about 3 hours 23 into this Masters of Endurance 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing.
Gonna stay on board here. Another little battle is going on. Core Motorsports just passed JCL Sim Racing. Also flipping to another one, which just behind them actually is Virgil Racing, right on the back of NX Racing Blue.
Yep, you're riding on board with Marcus Johansson, Virgil Racing right now, behind that BMW of Jason Lovett. There's a name I've not seen for a while.
Yeah, all the way back from Lift for Speed days. He's been doing MOE for probably 6 years now.
Yeah, and he looks like he's really under pressure from Johansson as they head up to the bus stop.
Whoa, Jason took that curb mighty hard.
Yeah, and Johansson gets on the throttle a little early in the exit of the chicane and has to spin up the rear wheels and loses a bit of time. He's sort of weaving around, trying to distract Lovett, but I'm sure Lovett is a... Oh, he slides it into the source. I don't think that really worked for him. It looked good, but that was sort of Sebastian Loeb style at Macau.
Definitely pushing it quite a bit. Definitely not going to look before Rouge. Trying to get into his head a little bit.
Yep.
Have to be careful here. I mean, you saw Marcus backed out quite a bit. It's just basically the aero push when behind a car. Might have overdone it just a little bit, but you got to be careful more than anything. You don't want to push wide and then have to lift too much on the exit of the corner.
Yeah, so this is a battle for P13. It's one of the closer battles on track. Keeping an eye on, there's a few others who are probably going to start happening soon, such as Team Camara number 2, which is car 54, versus also, Radicals Online.
I was also going to say, position number 3, we have Coanda, who just got passed by GT Ross. However, I believe Martin Kronk again just let them by, knowing, you know, hey, I got old tires, you can go.
Yeah. So, just an update, Vortex Racing, who we saw take P20, from what I recall, and then immediately crash. They're down in P57 after a very, very, very long pit stop. I mean, they did end up upside down, so it's not surprising, but yeah, they're almost last.
Yeah, it's a big shame to hear right there.
Yeah.
So another battle on track here. Mohamed Espatel for Team Camaro, right on the back of Radicals Online 2.
Yep, Vincenzo Amico for Micho for Radicals Online 2 in that roof, and yep, the McLaren of Team Camaro just behind as they go into Eau Rouge.
Again, have Virgil Racing right on the back of NX Racing Blue. Marcus definitely looks to be the faster car right now.
Yeah, he's getting close again, is that Marcus Johansson. Still not got past Jason Lovett just yet. But InX Racing Blue. They qualified in position 14, and they are currently position 13, so they're nothing if not consistent.
Yeah, we saw them as high up as... I think it was pit stops and stuff. We saw them in the top five or close to it.
Yeah, but I believe
we've had some slowdowns and whatnot since then.
In terms of the championship, they are 34th. They didn't score. They didn't. They weren't in the first round of the championship. They scored 50 points in round two.
Yeah, first round of the championship, they got a nasty bug to where their car, even though they chose the BMW and had the number eight chosen, for some reason that gave them a McLaren a completely different number.
Yes, that's a nice, not a nice way to kick off your season.
Yeah.
Virgil Racing. I'm never going to get that right. Virgil Racing, Johansson still looking. Now, they started up in 12th position and they're currently 14th. In the standings, they are 26th. They didn't take part in the first round of the season.
They did. I hate to correct you. Virgil Racing, they actually were doing really good, and then they had an accident in the King, I believe it was.
So I see a blank space in the championship standings. I assume it's a non-participation.
Points.
Yeah, I thought I knew. But yes, and they scored 63 in Suzuka, and it looks like they're about to almost bump drafting there with Jason Lovett.
He's getting a little impatient, which I would be as well, following someone like this and not able to get around.
The drop
and they
is
are
strong.
Catching the car ahead of them as well, so it's not like they're going slow.
Yeah, car ahead. Ooh, slithering down the inside is Johansson. And that requires Jason Lovett to stay wide, but he stays ahead, more importantly. Yeah, car ahead is JCR Sim Racing car, Alexandre Chaudron, who is 11th. Lapping, like you say, about a third of a second slower than these two who are battling.
Yeah, there's actually quite a few teams that are in the 20s ahead of them, so it's not like they're running slow whatsoever.
I guess they're just pushing each other hard.
Virgil's getting a nice draft as well, so they're saving a little bit of fuel in the process. Also want to note that since NX Racing Red have got the lead, they are 2.5 seconds ahead of Team Redline. So they've pulled a little bit of a gap.
Oh, Virgil had a good run out of, Franier, but was unable to take advantage because Jason Lovett's car was there. So I think that was out of Stabilo, in fact, as they head into Blanchimont. And he's going around the outside of Blanchimont. That is that's certainly something. And he breaks and they make contact. That was not a wise move. Unbelievable. Jason Lovett is now down to 14th place. I can't believe they got away with that.
I honestly have no idea how they did that. It was there. It looked like Jason pushed up a little bit into him.
I mean, to be fair, Jason had to take a tight line because the Virgil car was there and he's sort of washed out. He looks at the replay, my goodness, that was lucky.
Yeah, washed out the smallest of margins, but when that happened, I mean, Marcus definitely held a tight line there. And then once he got pushed a little wide, Jason had to lift off and then Marcus gave him a bunch of room there to by going off the track a little bit.
Yeah, but now he's quite a way ahead now. In fact, I think Jason lost a little bit of time. And Marcus is now looking at JCL Sim Racing as his next target.
Yep. About 2.8 seconds ahead. I think he'll be able to catch him within the next 10 laps or so. call me crazy here, but we're going to go all the way back to the 47th and 48th position.
Yeah, I was about to say the same, actually. They're the closest battle on track.
Yes, we have Monster Energy Endurance. And actually, number 128, I believe he's new for this round. I don't want to say.
Yeah. First entry. Apologies for the horrendous pronunciation. We were actually given a guide for that one, but I still don't know what I'm saying. So yes, that's Fevichan Ochan.
Whoa!
Looking up the inside of Jolton and Tio of Monster Energy. Oh, he gets hit off the rear. The turkey car gets hit off the rear by Direct Clutch, who then passes him, but lets him back through again. I think Brad Whitten breaks a little late. And yeah, felt a bit bad about it, and let the Team Turkey car continue.
Can I call it Turkey?
It's...
I don't know what it is either, to be honest.
And Brad Wooden gets back past again, so he waited one corner to then actually make the move.
Yeah, Brad is actually a lap ahead.
Oh, you're so, right, yes. Yes, you're correct.
Apparently, Direct Clutch is in the 30th position. So...
Turkia is the pronunciation, I just checked.
Turkia, wow. Oh, whoa, have another strong little battle here. Whoa, Team Camaro, number one car. We have, was it Phoenix Motorsport, also Vortex. Four-car train here, to be exact.
Yeah, that is a gaggle.
All McLarens as well.
In the Team Camaro car, yeah, and side by side with the McLaren of Phoenix Motorsports, Jose Almeida. This is, 33rd, 34th, 35th. And yeah, the car at the back is the Vortex Sim Racing car recovering. Ashley Owen. That car's got quite a lot of positions in the last time, since the last time we looked.
Yes, it has. Looks like Vortex did get a fast repair there.
Hang on a second. No, there are two Vortex and Racing cars.
I believe we were watching the car, the number 20 car, though, when it crashed.
Oh, right, okay. But yeah, the other Vortex Sim Racing car is down in 57th. Which would make sense because of their accident. But yeah, you may well be right. But yeah, so you're looking at Jamie Orson, Team Camaro car, now in 33rd. And that Phoenix Motorsports car, though, still not being shaken off. That car actually had an accident at Blanchimont earlier today, I believe. Got away with it, just.
Yes, the Phoenix Motorsports car. See the Glacier Racing car in the background. I heard a little bit of contact there. But the Glacier Racing car in the background, they are currently in the sixth position. Great job by them. A lap ahead of all the cars in front of them.
Yeah, Lotari's been in the car this entire time, so that's, he's going to be 4 hours in by the time he's done. I think, next stint will be Jonny Hagner, I think, getting in the car, who we've heard from earlier.
Oh, he didn't do the very first stint. I believe that was Alexi Alonso, but since then, yeah, he's been in the car.
Coming down the straight, Jose Almeida in that McLaren, passing the other McLaren to Jamie Wilson. On the inside into Lake Coombe. He breaks later. And yeah, it looks like Jose Almeida has got this one. Signed, sealed, delivered. That is P33.
That's great. Great pass there.
We have a battle developing between number 19 and number 2, which is JCL Sim Racing and Virgil Racing. In fact, Virgil Racing just going past now. As they go into Lake Coombe, that's the roof passing the BMW in Alexandre Chardron, JCL Sim Racing. Just caught the end of that. It's a good clean move, just about pretty much a repeat of what we just saw from.
We have a bunch of battles going on now, actually. Now we have the number 52, the number 10. Number 74, actually, directly back behind in their BMW.
Yeah, I think Manuel Sanchez and Sanchez in the last lap car let Adecoba Lopez through. He was a little bit slower going into Blanchemont. I think he allowed him through, possibly, maybe because of a slowdown. And yeah, behind them is Bert Ekmans for Flux Racing. Not seen, well, actually looked seen them so far today. So they're, yeah, P27. P28, sorry. And yeah, Koba Lopez of the Iberico Racing Team. They had been running in the top five, top six for most of this race, but they received a drive-through for consistently running off track at Blanchimont, and they had to take a drive-through. So they're now recovering.
Looking at the gap here between the top two cars, you can actually see the third place in the background there as well. Top three separated by 7.7 seconds. Sounds like a lot, but really is pretty much nothing right now.
Yeah.
3.3 seconds between the top two. But I think this is kind of expected after the Suzuka race, 1,000 kilometers, roughly 6 hours at Suzuka, and it literally came down pretty much to the last lap, the top two battling, bumper to bumper, door to door, the last few laps there.
Yeah, it was a superb race, that one. And yeah, Team Redline, Inex Racing Red, who currently lead, not won a race so far this season, but have come second and third, third and fourth. Third and second, there we go, numbers. Yep. And just ahead of the NX Racing Red, there's a battle, not a battle, but two cars getting a bit involved with each other, the Macau Racing car of Scott Gray and John G. Hill of CTC Racing 2. They are having all sorts of trouble, so that NX Racing car is going to have to be a bit careful as he negotiates them.
Yeah, for sure, got to be very patient here. Also have to remember, even though, you know, well, actually, and I don't know if you noticed this, but look at the car in front of NX Racing Red and the car behind NX Racing Red.
Surrounded by cows.
Yep.
That is terrifying. Up the inside of first, the other cow. The other cow, I guess. And now it's time to get past the CTC Racing car, who stays on the outside. Should be relatively easy for Jake Sturgis to take that, to lap that car. Now, yeah, the Mad Cow car in the background, the McLaren, is in 14th, and the other Mad Cow, BMW, is in 39th. Now putting a lap on the CTC racing car, the black BMW that was in 53rd. It is in 53rd, in fact. I guess those two cow cars, they're traveling in a herd.
I was trying to get them both on stream here where you could see them so they can have a nice lifelong memory of it.
So yeah, they need to like get a photo finish together.
To get side by side later on, I'm sure to get a shot of it.
Yeah. Yeah, I imagine they will, because yeah, that Mad Cow Racing 2 car is a fair way quicker than the Mad Cow 1 car.
Also have, actually this isn't a battle brewing. Just missed a pass actually between the number 126 and number 45. Number 45 is New World Sim Sports Scarlet. Number 126 is All-Star Racing Team 3. All-Star Racing actually has three cars in this race.
I think that's more than anyone.
Yes, it is.
Team Redline in second place have just negotiated the one of the cow cars and is on his way to do the second. Now, what was on track? I think there's a bit of a battle developing between 52 and 74. That's Last Lap Motorsports. And in fact, yeah, let's go have a look at car 10, Iberica Racing Team. It's coming up on the 25th place Christian Schick Racemore team. That BMW.
Crowd racing.
Yes, indeed. And round the outside, down the straight, down the Kennel straight. And he's ahead.
See the car ahead. Oof. Actually, it looked like he got a slow down there.
Yes, indeed. And that was for position.
Yes. Yeah.
That was the cracked racing team of Segundo Martinez, who obviously took a bit too much curve over the corner. Eau Rouge and Radio. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I don't know where to turn this corner in the world.
F1's in this off season, so it's clear. You're forgetting all the corner names.
Yeah, what's racing? I don't know. This is my main motorsport for the winter at this point. So, yeah, still looking at that Iberica car who made one position but is now about to lap the Dream Factory car.
Another one here is Koyama SimSport on the back of Team TTL. I feel like that's already happened before, but now it's happening again.
Groundhog Day. Indeed, yeah. Right behind the orange and black McLaren is the Team TTL car with Richard Hampson at the wheel. And up the inside goes Andre Butcher with Coanda, that white BMW. I remember it was Butcher who actually, just at the next corner, suffered the big crash of the 91 car that was in the way. It wasn't Butcher's fault at all. But yeah, he switched up. That was the last time we saw him. He was without a bonnet, driving back from the pit lane.
Yeah, I just want to note also, this is after they've done a pit stop. So this is actually really their current position, the eighth spot. They have, as you can see, 5 seconds up to settle the position.
That's really, really good. Really good recovery drive. Not be surprised to see them back at, you know, in the top five by the end.
Yeah, they've been doing a great job closing up. Interesting little situation here. Positions 18th and 19th, Pure Racing Team 3 and Pure Racing Team 2. Currently in a battle for position.
Yeah, so the car behind, the McLaren, is Lars Conrad in P19. Yeah, P18 for Mert Uzel, Pure Racing Team number 3.
Lars on about 5 lap fresher tires. I guess I'll play a little bit of a role here as well. It's quite strange, actually. Pure Racing Team expected a little bit stronger performance. I mean, this, once again, very, very early into the race. Not even 4 hours yet. Road America, I believe they finished, I want to say, 5th. They got passed on the 8th to last lap by Core Motorsports. Don't know how I remember that. Yeah, now they're back in 19th. I think by the end of this, we'll see them much farther ahead.
Yeah, Pure Racing Team 3, which is the BMW, qualified in 26th and is now 18th. Pure Racing Team 2 qualified 33rd and are in P19.
Okay.
So they're doing pretty well relative to their starting position.
Yeah, they have been climbing through the field then. So, all right, I didn't realize they started that far back, actually.
Yeah, and where did the other Pure Racing Team 1 started 7th?
Okay, that's what I thought.
Yeah, and they are, where are they at the moment? They are 41st, so they've had some problems.
Wow. Another battle on track here between the 109. Crax Racing Team and also the Flux Racing Team. See on screen now. Actually, the car behind them, as you can see, the roof, is Last Lap Motorsports, also in this battle. Actually, Actually, this is the closest battle we have on track, and there's three of them. I want to note that the top three, and they all have a very similar pace, even though they're in all three different cars. However, their pace is so good that fourth place is 1 minute 40 seconds behind the lead, whereas third place is only 10 seconds behind the lead. So very, very strong run by the top three cars. NX Racing Red, Team Red Line, and GT Wilson. Oh! Sorry about that. Saw the 109 car just now lose the rear end there. Oh, lost it again. Now, very careful rejoin here. Oh, nope. Reset the car there. Probably too much damage as we see the two Pure Racing Team cars switch positions. It's actually a very tough corner to get the throttle down on. You're going downhill and it's kind of, I wouldn't really say off camber. The rear of the car, especially in the BMW, can step out, spin off to the right. As we actually just saw their Vortex Sim Racing, the number 20 McLaren in the background now. Went wide and Puhon. Team TTL now separates this two-car battle. I'm going to jump all the way up to Coanda SimSport in the eighth position. Remember, they got around Team TTL, which is now 4 seconds back, and they've already within right around 1 second of Team Camaro 2. Which even though it's Team Camaro 2, they've been driving all season if it's their number one car. Quite a few very fast drivers in that. Mohamed's actually a very good 4GT driver, as much as I've seen him race, the GT2 car. And also Ben Testing, Simon Trindell. Don't know their fourth driver currently, if they even have one. Kind of now just about to sniff the draft here.
So, looking at Andre Butcher now, looking to catch the cars ahead of him, and it is it's a battle for P7 that we're going to be looking at soon. It's the Mohamed S. Patel Team Chimera car in 7th, that white McLaren. I think we're going to be looking at a pass pretty soon. Butcher taking it nice and easy, actually. Lifting off nice and early. Just not, you know, there's no pressure, really. He's looking at 7th position. I mean, they've had an amazing recovery drive. He's putting messing up now with an aggressive pass, so he's doing just a nice, gentle journey up to the back of Patel's car. I mean, you might want to wait until Patel has negotiated his way past a few of these back markers, but we don't know if he'll be able to do that. It depends how fast the back markers are. And they include Rincon Racing, Team Camaro, the other Team Camaro car, and JCL Sim Racing. Ooh, he takes a look, and then that BMW pulls to the inside, a 91, 93 car, sorry, which was actually the car that they crashed into earlier, the car that Butcher crashed into earlier, as a no fault of Butcher, is the 93 car in the middle of the road that caused the problem. Butcher's lost a bit of time there to the Patel Team Camaro car.
And for those wondering, it says Butcher's been driving for 34 laps. No, he has not on the stint. Hasn't actually counted his last pit stop, which was Martin Kronk getting out for Andre Butcher.
Yep. In fact, now he's caught right up to the back of Patel again. He is now stuck behind Yassine Lebert with JTR Team Racing. That black, the grey red McLaren, which runs wide.
Yeah, that was very wide.
That car in P31. Ooh, a little awkward. Very, very awkward, this one. He almost looks like he's getting out of the way, but then isn't.
And this just really holds everybody up. It's even losing himself time. I don't understand the reasoning behind this.
Yeah, I think he's sort of trying to let him pass, but sort of doing it in a manner that is slightly half-hearted, unfortunately. Like, he's giving what he thinks is enough room, but then sort of cutting back in. But yes, they've lost quite a lot of time behind him. Now he's let them pass into Blanchimont, so it works out all right. But yeah, they lost maybe a couple, 2 or 3 seconds on that lap. We're nearly 4 hours now into the Masters of Endurance 24 hours of Spla.
Spla. That's 1/6 of the way in.
I've already lost my mind.
Hey, at least you don't have to be here all night.
Yeah, indeed. Yes, I you have been. People are pretty heroic. Spa is the word. Yes, Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing. We're going to have another IGP code giveaway in a few minutes, so keep your eyes peeled for that. Another a year's subscription to the service, complete with a 2D pack worth $50. So, you know, if you like a bit of sim management, that is the game for you. As we watch Andre Berkshire now look to the inside as they go into Lakeview and completes the pass for 7th position on Patel, the Team Camara. In the end, it was simple, but it took a while to happen.
Now Andre's going to be looking about 2.5 to 3 seconds ahead for Shinzo and Miko for Radicals Online 2. That'd be for the 6th spot.
Yep, that car, yeah, just coming through Kuan at the moment, just exiting as Butcher was entering. So yeah, there's a few seconds in it, probably about 2.5 at this point.
Actually, Andre's cut the gap down just this lap alone.
Oh yeah, 2.2 now.
We have to understand that, yes, he does have a little bit fresher tire, so he will be catching these cars a little bit faster, but, he also is pretty quick himself.
Yeah, you just saw that gravel kicked up on the screen. That was, in fact, from Vincenzo Nicho of Radicals Online 2, so a little mistake.
Huge mistake here by Team Redline. They have right side damage. Sure what happened here, but they're about to be passed for the 2nd position, I believe.
Yeah, they are under big pressure from GT Ross SST Silver. I'll go back and have a look and see what they did. Maybe with contact with a back marker, perhaps. I guess we'll have to see. And yeah, that is Samuel De Fuente in the roof, the GT Ross SST Silver. And he's looking at the inside into Blanchimont. He's still there on the inside. You see Yakula, oh, takes a really, really aggressive line. I mean, I guess that's sort of his normal line, really wide, and keeps that second position amazingly.
He definitely doesn't want to give that away.
So he come down the straight for another lap.
That was actually the other GT Rolls car right there pitting.
Oh, yeah.
I believe. Maybe. No, it wasn't. I'm sorry. I missed that. I don't know who that was. It looked like it was a GT Rolls car, though. The GTRS, my fault. They're very, very close. Not only in name, but also in paint scheme.
So, unfortunately, on my iRacing, I can't see what happened to Redline.
Yeah, cars limited.
Oh. Let me turn that off. Because my PC is definitely good enough. Right? Oh, I've got max cars on 60, so I don't know what's been going on. Anyway, so in the end, the red line managed to just about stay ahead for now, but I wonder if that damage is affecting the performance of the car.
Oh, and it actually, yeah, just got word of who this was from. It looked like they got into them and the 93 car got together.
It's not the first time they've been involved, unfortunately. Oh, Yakula nearly loses it going through the left-hander. But yes, that is... oh dear, and in fact, it looks like the reason for the collision was that 93 had spun out of Rochelle. So it's pretty much the same part of the track and the same car that upset Coanda. Luckily, not to such a huge extent with Redline. They've kept their second position, but still, Rincon Racing having an absolute nightmare, and I'm sure the stewards will be taking a look at that.
Currently riding on board with GT Rolls Silver Car. You can see the last lap times, you can see how much Team Redline lost.
They lost about 8 seconds. Maybe 9 seconds. So yeah, I imagine they probably came to a halt.
It's just something that's really unpredictable, to be honest.
So the report from the stewards is that that the car, the 93 car had spun. It wasn't Bouchard actually, we're getting confirmation where that was, but it was, it was the left-hander after Bouchard, so it is exactly the same place that they spun earlier, and it reversed across the track. And yeah, that's how they were collected by Redline, so yes.
Unfortunate situation there. And now actually GT Rolls are, I wouldn't really say they're getting held up. Alexei, you know, put back a decent time. I mean, he went off here a little bit last lap, so doesn't look like he's that much slower, if at all. That right front damage isn't going to help him, as we can see here.
Oof, just running off the road, but keeping it on. Whoa. In fact, just yeah. Yes, Samuel De Fuente actually had a little moment himself on the exit. It's really, really close. It's probably the best, most important battle on circuit right now. It's Jake Sturgios in the NX Racing red car. I've forgotten all about him. 15 and a half seconds up the road now. Looking for their first win in the season.
If you want to win one of them, I guess this would be it.
Yes, exactly. Not only for the points, but also just for the glory.
Yeah. And it's still, Alexei's still nailing Blanchimont.
Yep, that's probably one of his strongest parts of the track. He just has a line that no one else seems to do. That wide entry gives him a good run of speed.
Also want to note that... Actually, we're going to flip to that really, really quickly. Andre Butcher has caught Vincent... Wow. Vincenzo Amico.
So that is... yeah, that's for 6th and 7th. Cardinal SimSport versus that roof you can see in front.
That Radical's online too. And also a little bit further back, not going to flip to it just yet, but we have Team TTL, Core Motorsports, and Virgil Racing all battling. As we have Coanda now going to look on the inside.
Ooh. And that's a move completed. Just. Yes, that's done. There were two corners in which you could do it, and he managed to complete the move. Very neat and tidy.
Now we're going to flip to Virgil Racing. You can see Core Motorsports and Team TTL just ahead. Two roofs trying to challenge a McLaren.
Yeah, battle for ninth. Yeah, riding a wall with Virgil. It's Marcus Anderson driving. Ahead is Alexander Voss for Core Motorsports. And yeah, Richard Hampstead in that TTL car into Launch 1. Bit further back, further back in terms of where they are relative on the track, the second place red line car. Oh, in fact, he's pulling into the pit lane, so that's the start of the fourth round of pit stops.
Oh yeah, thankfully that happened so close to pit stops, so they're able to pit now and get that damage squared away. I don't believe they've used any of their faster pairs.
I guess not. Meanwhile, back at the battle you were looking at before, the battle for ninth, you're still riding a ball with Johansson. Right, so TTL car holding its own, Richard Hampstead. Having no trouble keeping the Core Motorsports car behind him. Just driving his own line. I say that, the Core Motorsports car, I think, ran into the back of him.
Yeah, that was close there. Quite surprised here. I thought they caught up to Team TTL, but they haven't been able to make a move just yet.
Yeah, into the right-hander, Franier, and then the left. Yeah, TTL's really doing a good defense. I don't know if it's in their interest to do that, because they're probably going to be losing time driving defensively. And he gets a big old slide, but it sort of carried him into the corner, so it's actually worked out in his favor in the end. It was in through Stavolo.
I'm actually going to move up to the Core Motorsports car here on board.
So you're right, yep. Alexander Voss really has a good chance now. Gets on the throttle sooner into the bus stop. Can he brake later? Yes. And I think he's going to seal it. Yes, I think he's done it. He just parked himself on the apex, and that is ninth position for Core Motorsports, passing Richard Hampstead, Team TTL.
Just want to note that NX Racing Red have just entered the pits, and also we see Virgil Racing going past Team TTL right now.
Yep, that's a straight up slipstream move there. That was easy. Almost carried too much speed into Lacoon, but he just got it slowed down. We got Marcus Johansson up into ninth for Virgil. So we've just passed 4 hours into the Masters of Endurance 24 Hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing. 20 hours still to go, but it has been a real good race so far. These guys have not been driving like it's a 24-hour race, they've been driving more like it's a 3-hour race. And yeah, it's been a real thrill at the moment, and we're just coming into the fourth round of pit stops now, so this is where all the shaking up happens, but we would imagine INEX Racing Red, who are in pits at the moment, will come back out in the lead, having taken that lead in the last stint from the pole sitters, Team Redline, in their McLaren.
Yes, they did a driver swap there. Jake got out for brother PJ, older brother PJ. Surprised. You know what's funny is they've actually tested before to see, like, doing a hot swap, see, like, using the same computer and just swapping seats. And PJ has admitted to the fact that he can't do it. Jake, like, their setups are so different. Jake can't drive on PJ's setup either. Just something about it is just so different. They can't do it.
Oh, big moment for Core 33 Motorsports. They had a big moment at the exit of the bus stop and have been passed by Virgil. Yeah, I think sim racing is really very, very personal because there's so many variables you can change, particularly in iRacing. So many things you can change. Yeah, I wouldn't want to drive. Like, I have a very weird setup, and I always struggle with anyone else's setup, to be honest.
Yeah,
so, yeah, I totally understand that.
I have one of those homemade setups, so I have a seat that's built on a wooden stand to where it doesn't move, pedals that are stacked up using styrofoam and some metal, and a 30-inch monitor that's on a desk that shakes as if, well, it could fall at any moment.
Wow, sounds dangerous.
Yeah, but I think it's kind of like racing, you know, you don't want to crash, so you don't want the screen to fall on you. So it's kind of like a safety measure to make sure you don't crash.
You end up with your face going through a monitor. You have to carry it around with you.
Also to note that Team Redline, after the pit stop, has changed drivers. Another DWC, very, very, very strong DWC driver, Ali Pakala, currently in the car.
His first stint of the race.
Yes, first actually in Masters of Endurance as well.
Good time to make your debut.
And as we can see, the right front of their car has been repaired. So thankfully, they had a fast repair to fix that.
So, leading is GT Ross SST Silver by just under a minute and a half. Once Samuel De La Fuente pits, he will fall back into the position he was in before, which was, I think, fourth?
Third.
Third.
Yeah, it's quite interesting. Number 112 car, who was fourth, has not pit yet. The top three were separated by 10 seconds, back to 15 before because of the red line incident. And after that, fourth place was a minute and a half behind. So the top three is putting on an amazing pace right now. All three different makes. So it's quite interesting to see.
Closest battle on track is probably car 41 versus car 10, which is Glacier Racing in the Ford GT. Coming up to the Iberica Racing team, car of Ade Cobo Lopez. I think these two, as Iberica, yes, Iberica is actually hasn't made their fourth pit stop yet. Well, they have.
They were off a little bit because of, actually no, they're 17 laps into their stint. Yeah, they had a drive-through.
So these guys are, yeah, Glacier Racing pitted recently, so they are on fresh tyres, so they should get past with relative ease into 12th place.
I believe these guys had a pretty tough battle earlier.
Yeah, these two have found themselves in loads of battles. They've had a really fun race for us to watch. Into Blanchimont.
Wow.
Is, well, a little bit of a wobble in the corner there for the Glacier car.
Johnny Hagner got into the car. He doesn't want to mess around, apparently.
It's first stint, two laps in, already doing some daring moves. Fair play. That car will probably come back into fifth or sixth once the pit stops are over.
I think he'll be in the sixth position, and he will have, I want to say Andre Butcher not far behind him. I believe is what's going to happen. Or Coanda. Okay. They might do a driver swap. Not too sure on the gaps there.
No, Berica car is not settled yet, though. He's sort of coming back at him, but I don't think there's not really any benefit to passing the Glacier car, because that Glacier car is much faster at this point in the race because of the fresh tyres.
Exactly. Oh, and I was about to say that Team Redlines caught Core Motorsport and Virgil Racing. However, both of those cars have just entered the pits.
Yep, that's for their fourth pit stops of the race. It's Marcus Johansson and Alexander Voss in.
Trying to find other little battles around the racetrack.
So let's give away another one of our IGP codes. This will get you a year's worth of IGP 2D pack subscription worth $50. Go to igpmanager.com to enter the code coming on screen right now. The code is 46841. It's first come, first serve.
Also for new or existing accounts, so don't worry, if you have an account, you want another year, hurry up and do it. Beat everybody else.
That's igpmanager.com. Thank you, IGP, for supporting Masters of Endurance.
Yeah, massive thanks to Jack Bassford. Big time MOE racer, and now is helping support us.
So we've got 22 more of those to give away. Some of them appear on Twitter, so at Masters of Endu, or on Facebook, which is, I think, facebook.com/Masters of Endurance.
Yep,
and
currently on screen
also,
right now.
Yeah, and we'll also put some more up on the stream as we go through the next 20 hours.
Note that Virgil Racing just came out of the pits and they are right behind Team GTL. Actually, this is a bunch of cars for position here. One of the first cars you saw on stream there is Radicals Online 2 in their roof, and then followed by Team GTL, their McLaren, Virgil Racing as you see right here, and then just behind them is Team Camaro 2 and their McLaren, and then Core Motorsports in their roof. So yeah, all these cars are battling, and you can see possibly in the background there was an X Racing Red.
It's a good little battle building. That's after pit stops as well, so yeah, we can have a good hour of this. The car at the front of that train is P45. That's the Marlboro Motorsport car of Nico Lyrki. Car number 77. That car is a couple of laps down, so it's not part of the battle. But yes, the battle starts at P13, I believe, with the all-cool Ibrink Radicals Online 2.
First time we've seen Paul, I believe, this race.
No, I think he was around a couple of stints ago.
Okay, yeah, actually, no, you're right, because I talked about how he drives in HPD and other endurance events.
Indeed. Now he's looking to get past that Marlboro car. Oof, thinks better of it through Blanchimont. Doesn't want to think too hard though. Actually, no, he's got a good gap over Matthew Hill, Team TCL, so he can afford to take his time. Matthew Hill just gets himself up past that Marlborough car as well. It's a little bit close.
Yeah, Marlborough car just ran wide there as well and kind of just ran the cars off the track that were behind him. Almost like he didn't even know they were back there.
Virgil just about got away with it, but then, the core car, and I think the Canberra car lost a bit of time. He's still not got past him yet. In fact, I think the core motorsports car, 33, might have a chance of passing the Canberra car of Mohamed Patel in P12 right now.
An interesting situation brewing with the roofs currently. We see that the current leader is still out on track. And basically what they're doing is they're trying to extend the stints, and they're basically able to do that one lap each time. So they should possibly be able to completely cut out a pit stop, if not definitely a short pit. So
yeah. So you've got, PJ Sturgis, the red BMW, is coming through with these guys. Is the currently P2, but will be P1 once the GT Ross silver car pits. They kind of spread out a bit, those guys, actually. It's that Marlborough car sort of split them up. But I think
it's split everyone up there, actually.
The core Motorsports 33 is the right at the back of that train in P13, looking to pass the Camaro. As you can see in the back of that shot.
Also in front of these guys is Virgil Racing trying to get past Team TTL.
Yeah, Stefan Mujibar. And Matthew Hill in Team TTL car. That's the first time he's been on. That's his first stint in the race.
Yes, it is. As you see, the Marlboro car lets an X Racing Red by. To see if Core Motorsports and Team Camaro can get by as well. Looks like they will be able to. Yes, Marlboro car runs very wide there.
Nils Koch of Core running through Eau Rouge now. And the car comes up just ahead of him. He might try and use it slipstream. In fact, that car is Thomas Halonen of KRT Motorsport. P17. It was P17 at the start, so that's probably much further down now. GT Ross silver car still not pitted yet.
As you say that, he literally...
Oh, brilliant.
...has just entered the pits.
Well, yeah. Technically, it was true. At the moment I said it. And the 33 Core Motorsport are now really all over the back of the Camaro car. Really like that 11th spot. So De La Fuente had a 1 minute 32 second gap over the leader, so come back out in third.
Actually, yeah, I'm not sure where they've come out. I was looking and Ollie's...
Maybe so.
Yeah, Ollie's quite a way behind NX Racing Red. Which I'm not sure how that really happened.
Yeah, that's like 40 seconds gap. As Nils Koch is going to make a move at the bus stop, we'll There's a defence from Patel, but not enough, and that is P11 for Core Motorsports. But yes, what is up with that? Because they've both done the same one.
Enough.
Hmm. So yeah, it's a 38-second gap between InX Racing Red and Team Redline.
However, we do have Jani Hagner pressuring GT Ross Orange quite a bit. I was curious to see what this GT Ross, their lineup further down, and currently they're on the third driver now. Looks like he's a little bit slower than Christian Lorente and the other drivers for the team. I am also judging him after one lap, so I am a terrible person. Apologies for that.
Harsh.
Yeah, I didn't realize it was only a second lap out of the pits, so.
Yeah.
Shake off those cobwebs.
I can't find out what happened to Redline, if anything.
Jani Hagner's going to be pretty antsy to get by here.
Jani Hagner, who we spoke to earlier, yeah, as I say, looking pretty keen on that fifth, but Enrique Lopez is not going to make that easy for him.
Another interesting.
I think it's Enrique, sorry, not Enrique.
Oh, I almost want to say Enrique, to be honest. I don't know. But I also want to note that PJ Sturgis for NX Racing Red now has a 26-second gap over GT Ross Silver. Remember, it was 15 to 16 seconds before pit stops. However, due to them having different tires, it's made the lead quite large. So curious to see here. Also, David Mata for GT Roast Silver, currently in the second position. New driver for them as well.
I was just thinking, maybe the gap between Redline and... Because then now they're third. Well, now they're fourth.
Well, Coanda, I understand them being there.
Yeah,
it's weird.
But you know, they're 30 seconds behind the leaders, and we know 39 seconds behind the leaders. We know they lost 9 seconds in that incident with car 93, but that doesn't explain the rest of the time. They're not the first time in my life, and definitely not the last. I'm confused. Still watching Jani Hagner.
I'm curious to see here if he's going to make a move anytime soon. If anything, he's almost been losing time a little bit.
Yeah, I think he's a good thing to watch. A big run of speed, but he's not able to use it. But he might
go
for
very
an inside.
Close.
Yes. But it has to break earlier.
Yeah, some defending going on. I don't think he wants to try to push it around the outside.
The tyres here on his own are 8 laps old versus Enrique Lopez is 3 laps old, but he's going around the outside into La Source, but that typically doesn't work. But actually,
he made it work.
Really?
Yeah.
So that to that wide line, let him carry more speed, whereas Lopez actually took a tight line that required him to slow down more. Good move. That's
actually,
fifth place.
Actually, we could have an update here from the Glacier Racing Squad, Yari Latari. Currently waiting to be interviewed.
So joining us in the commentary box, again, the second interview for Glacier Racing is Yari Latari. Hello, how are you doing?
Hi guys, I'm fine. Did you play the Benny Hill song?
No, we have not played the Benny Hill song yet.
Damn it.
So I saw you in IRC. You were saying what you were saying. I already had enough problems with Hagler's mentality. That can only end badly. What are you thinking?
Well, yeah, just the way things have been going, I had a pretty funny fight with Pablo Cobra Lopez. He couldn't actually understand that this car can be quicker than him. And then the incident with Danny Giusa at the Contentless Comms. So, if I'm already acting that badly, well, Agnes' mentality, he's a bit of a go-all-in guy, so that can only end badly.
Well, we learned that. His second lap in the car, he decided to make a pass at Blanchemont, so we kind of learned that he's going to go big or go home here.
Yeah, he's like that.
Yeah, we actually known him for quite a few years. He did Masters of Endurance and Lift for Speed, so we trust him a fair good amount to make some level-headed decisions.
Level-headedness with Hagner doesn't really work with go along. I mean, he's from Pori, and we actually make fun of him all the time that he's from Pori, because he's a bit nuts. But yeah, he's a good guy. He can do it, just as long as he wants to do it.
How do you guys feel about, well, we spoke to Yanni earlier, how do you feel about the Ford update? It really helped you guys out quite a bit.
Yeah, well, we are in P5 apps apparently, yeah. And yeah, the 45 kilogram reduce in weight is, well, it's really good. But then they changed the deep drive ramp angle, which made the car so that you can't really, even though it has traction control, you can't really put your throttle down at the corner exit, it will slide out. The ramp angle does it so that it's really, really slippery when going on power. So okay, they kind of balanced it out.
How many stints are you planning on doing? Have you got more to come overnight, or are you going to do more tomorrow?
These three were my last for today. I'll be back in the car at somewhere around 400 hours UTC. I'm guessing it's the night stint, which is the problem one, but I don't actually have a clue who's going to drive tonight. And well, that's not any news for us, because it's Glacier, we can't really plan anything. But my plan is to get back in at 0600 finish time, which is GMT plus 2, and then do at least 3 stints in a row.
Are you one to enjoy multiple stints in a row like that? 3 stints? I know normally it's like more around 2 stints is normally people are comfortable with, but I see you did 3. Are you okay with that normally?
It was actually, I did that first time at Road America, and well, noticed that it's somewhat doable in my seat, so yeah, it's not something I do enjoy the last stint, but yeah, it's something you have to do to get the car into the finish line.
Just want to note on stream there, you did just see the number 62 car, I believe that's Trinity Motorsports 3, do a quick 360 exiting the final corner there, and also the Core Motorsports and Team TTL battle going on. Are you guys, well, I know Hagner said he'd be happy with a top 5 finish, I'm guessing you have the same thoughts?
I'm just happy if we finish.
Yeah, that's normally my mentality with a 24-hour race. If you get to the end without having massive problems, you've had a successful race.
I mean, the biggest fear I currently have is I'm going to sleep for six or seven hours and then wake up and see that our car is in the pits or something.
Yeah, that's always what I've been worried about as well. That's almost why I hate going to sleep during these races. I won't be going to sleep tonight because I'll be, well, on here. But it's just going to sleep and then not knowing what's going on with your team.
Yeah. But have anyone made a bet on when are you going to go conk out? Like Will Vincent did in the race spot 24 hours.
I know that I've done this before, the 2012 race and the final one in Live for Speed, the 24 hours. I did the full 24 hours. However, I did just completely pass out of my seat that I'm sitting in right now for about 45 minutes. I woke up and one of the European commentators just woken up and started doing an interview with somebody. And that's what I woke up to. I was on board with the car for 45 minutes because I was on the controls. So hopefully that doesn't happen again, yeah.
Yeah, let's hope so.
It should be good though. I'm nice and well prepared this race. I already packed up some sandwiches. I'm pretty much having a picnic or a little camping trip at my desk. So, should be good.
Yeah, and how has the off-track rule has been working?
We've been watching it carefully. We've been a little nice to some, like due to lag and stuff like that. We've been watching, and sometimes we can see a team just barely go over. And, you know, if they're from Australia or whatever, we have to try to be nice to them and say, hey, you know, we'll give you the benefit of the doubt. However, most of the time, some of the people going over aren't gaining time at all. If anything, they're losing time, like Pujon. You run wide in Pujon, you're not really gaining time.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're looking at different areas. Blanchimont, a lot of that's been people saving the car if they get a little sideways and whatnot. So, not been too hectic on that front. We are getting a lot of data, though, from teams that are, you know, going over the limit. However, it's just every time we check it, it's not that bad. Only penalty we've given out so far is the number 10 car, and that's because it was literally almost every other lap that it was happening, so, you know, there was no choice there.
Yeah, it was the same. I saw that, well, every time going Marshall mode, if you were just an inch off your normal line, it would just, the tail end would just a little bit wiggle and it would go wide.
Exactly. So, you know, we try to watch that and make sure that that's not happening. We don't want to, you know, wrongly penalize anyone. That wouldn't be fair.
Yeah, like Bill's identity. I'm sad that I'm not seeing the Neon Cat cars.
Wait, the
car.
Which one? Oh, Neon Cat, yeah. That's a very, very crappy situation. I don't know. Just the offending team needs to be a little bit more organized when they join the survey.
Yeah.
Only thing I can really say about that.
But still, I love the car.
Yeah, I know. Seeing that Neon Cat car is great. And we always have Neon Cat updates right beside the 4GT updates.
Yeah, it's pretty much. Those are my favorite.
Team too.
I think this race, another car we like is the Slow Fins.
Yeah, Slow Fins as well, just because they have basically just a huge warning sign as a paint scheme.
The speed limit sign.
Yeah. Great stuff.
Yeah,
Yari Lotari, thank you for joining us. Is there any shout outs you want to make, or websites, or anything that you want to mention?
No, big thanks to Clayser Racing and you guys for keeping Storo staying awake.
Ah, it's our job.
Yep.
Yeah,
well, thanks for chatting. Yeah, good luck with the rest of the race.
Bye.
Good luck.
So while we were having a chat there, you saw Nils Koch, number 33, pass the core motorsport. He passed Team TTL's Matthew Hill. And now it's Jason Lovett who's challenging that TTL car. In X-Racing Blue, Jason Lovett drives for. This is a battle for P10.
Just had a little bit of a wiggle there. And also, a car directly behind them is Pumped for a Team Camaro 2. All these cars have been within the top 10 at some point in the race. They've all definitely been in the top 15 all race. So, quite interesting to see, you know, how cars are going forward and backwards over the course of the race.
Quick update on the lead. PJ Sturgis for Inex Racing Red leads by 30 seconds over GT Ross Silver. David Matter at the wheel of the roof. And third is Team Redline, 41 seconds behind the lead. Ollie McCullough at the wheel of their McLaren. And Commander Simsport, who are out of sync, are in fourth position. And Glacier Racing, who you just heard from, in fifth.
Looks like NX Racing Red's currently putting all the way up to the sixth position lap down now. This is quite a big change compared to the races previous, where there's quite a few cars on the lead lap still at the end of the race. Spa's really, you know, taking its toll on quite a few teams. It's just a longer lap and a lot more tire wear, I believe, is the main issue here.
Joining us in commentary booth now is Mark Bormington from Blue Flag Racing, the title sponsor for this event. Welcome, Mark.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me. Looks like it's a great event already.
Yeah, have you been watching? I've seen you've been tweeting. What do you reckon so far? It's been pretty action-packed.
Yeah, I mean, I think you said it in the broadcast, it's a 24-hour race, but there are definitely some teams that are planning on going at it 100% rather than, I don't know, biding their time with strategy.
Yeah, speaking of which, in contact between Jason Lovett and Matthew Hill, but they got away with it again. So tell us a little bit about Blue Flag Racing. What teams are you guys into, and what sort of series are you competing in at the moment?
Well, we probably over the last 6-8 months finally managed to drag everybody kicking and screaming into iRacing, because before that it was very much R Factor, and just like Masters of Endurance, we were mainly involved in the endurance events, and before that it was, you name the single titles, we were racing them. So right now we're in what I call a chrysalis stage in the team. We're trying to reformat the team and set our sights on particular series moving forward. So the spirit of the Alenz one that we've run in, I've been doing extremely badly in the Sim Races Asia. A few of us race the V8's official series, but also the V8's Online Premier Series. We've got our eye on Masters of Endurance, so at the moment, each member of the team's trying to make sure we would be able to satisfy the iRacing criteria. But you name it, if it's going to be running for more than 3 hours, that's what we're aiming for.
Oh, cool. So how many drivers have you got? Oh, just a second. The Team TCL car just ran wide. Matthew Hill ran wide, and Jason Lovett now alongside him, side by side over the front straight. And Mohammed Patel looking at this and wondering, can I ever go into the first corner? And Jason Lovett remains on the inside. That's the BMW on the left of your picture. Remains into the first corner and completes the pass. He is now 10th. But Matthew Hill's coming back at him for into Eau Rouge, which could be a little bit tasty. Let's see if they...
He's fully alongside. Yeah, Jason's going to be smart here. Let up.
Yeah. And Jason Lovett has to slam on the brakes. And put a dab on the brakes at least, so as not to run into the back of Hill, and that means Patel is right in this, and he's going to go around the outside, possibly into Lacoum. No, he's lifting off. He doesn't want to be involved in this. That's the third car in your picture, the white McLaren that is the Mohammed Patel's Team Camaro car. So, yeah, Mark, yeah, how many drivers do you have in your team at the moment?
I was just counting on my fingers. And I've probably forgot someone. We're at about 9 or 10 active drivers at the moment, and we're currently in a, I won't say a recruitment drive, but we opened our doors for recruitment just last month. So we're trying to build up our GT team, build up our V8 team, because what we want to do is make sure we've got a solid foundation, and probably to try and cover every hemisphere. So if there is a 24-hour race we enter, we'll have drivers in Australia, North America and Europe. I must say, because I've just stepped away from the computer, just listening to the commentary on my phone, that was very Radio Le Mans-esque, so kudos, well done.
I really love that. We used to have a commentator actually who used to do these, who sounds just like John Hinhoff. But
I wish Chris was here. Everyone would be like, holy crap, who is that?
So yeah, you guys are on a recruitment drive. So what kind of drives are you looking for? Is there a certain culture to the team? Do you have to have a good sense of humour? What kind of people are you looking for?
You nailed it with culture, actually. It's that respectful one. We've got our tagline is real life comes first, but also the gentleman sim races. So we're one of those teams where we like banter just as well as anybody else, but when you pull on the blue flag racing labels, pretty much you're expected to be respectful, whether it's on the track or through any medium that you communicate. So we don't like creating drama and angst amongst the sim racing community. There aren't that many of us, so we'd much rather it was a peaceful, happy, lovely, joy place. So we take our sim racing seriously, but not too seriously. Everybody's got a real life. This is a hobby that we do. So pretty much we're laid back. We've been having discussions about whether we're too liberal, but we just like people to be able to get together, help each other. We don't need aliens or the fastest people in the world, just someone that likes to help support the other members of the team and is here to just have fun, really.
Okay, cool. And what would be the best way, if anyone's interested in having a look at your team, what's the best way to get in touch? Is it on the Facebook page, or is it the website that's best?
Facebook is probably the easiest. Facebook, because it's easiest to find, or our Twitter Twitter handle, at Blue Flag Racing. Send us a message, or just post us a message on our wall, and we'll just get in touch that way. We do have an email address for recruitment, but it's somewhat complex. So Facebook or Twitter is probably just easiest.
Cool, so that's facebook.com/ Blue Flag Racing. As we're just seeing on the stream, we've just seen Jason Lovett take that position finally into P10. Matthew Hill now 11th, and into 12th has gone. Actually, no, Simon Grayson is not in 12th, he's a lap down going from Patel. So yes, facebook.com/ Blue Flag Racing. That's the place to go if you want to get involved with the team. So yeah, well, thank you very much for supporting this race and offering up the prize money for the top three finishers. I'm sure they'll very much appreciate that, whoever ends up getting it.
Yeah, not a problem. As I said, it's a very small community. I think there's only like, 50, 60, 70,000 active sim racers on the globe. So anything we can do to support events like this, so no, more than welcome.
From what you've seen so far, who do you reckon, can you predict a winner or a top three you'll be handing that cash to? A giant check, perhaps.
Looks like we're going to be bankrolling Coanda or Team Redline. Not that either of those teams needs any more funds from anybody, but they're just two immense operations, so we've got the ultimate respect for them. But yeah, Team Redline look pretty solid, and I don't want to put any kiss of death on them, so I'm going to stop saying anything more.
All right, well, that probably has. As soon as you give anyone support, it needs a kiss of death, so I'm sure they'll thank you for that.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm going to shut up. Anybody on the track would be a worthy winner, actually. If you can survive 24 hours, what with net code and broadband issues and net contacts and all of the hardware that can overheat and melt down, and cats that can jump on your lap, anybody that can get a car to the end of a 24-hour event definitely deserves any prize money that's up for grabs.
Amen to that. Well, Mark Wallington from Blue Flag Racing, thanks for coming on. I'm sure we'll probably talk to you towards the end of the race as well, if you're still around. And yeah, we'll thank you for your support.
Yeah, no problem. And to everyone, have a great race and great commentary. Speak to you guys later.
Cheers. So, Mark Wilmington, Blue Flag Racing there. The official sponsor of the Masters of Endurance 24 Hours of Spa, Francorchamps. Currently leading the race, PJ Sturgios for Inex Racing Red has extended his gap to 35 seconds over GT Ross SST Silver, David Matta, Team Red Light, Oli Pakala in third, 43 seconds behind the leader. Grand Simsport in fourth position, fifth, Glacier Racing, sixth, Virgil Racing, seventh, Radicals Online 2, followed by Core Motorsports, GT Ross Orange, and 10th, Inex Racing Blue, Jason Lovett.
Have a strange little battle going on here. We have Yanni Hagner for Glacier Racing, currently ahead of NX Racing Red, but the odd situation is that, you know, NX Racing Red's on old tires, so they're a little off pace. But at the same time, you know, they're trying to get through, and Hagner's actually going to let him by there. That was a bit risky.
Yeah, he actually put his foot on the brake to, I guess, signify to PJ that he was going to let him through. Because he didn't actually slow down, he just sort of, it was a flash of light. That's one thing we need in this game. Hazard lights and indicators.
And I also want to note that Coanda saw them on stream going into the pits. We didn't say anything about it. Andre Butcher's pit, and now Klaus Kivikas.
Ooh, this is awkward. Virgil Racing having a go. Stefan Mitchell into Le Coum and has taken fifth position from Glacier Racing, who possibly held themselves up by letting the leader through. And behind is Paul Ulbricht. Radicals Online 2 now smells blood and wants to pass Glacier as well.
Exactly. And it's odd, actually. Glacier was getting the draft from NX Racing Red, but then Virgil kind of put him in a spot to where Glacier couldn't break late into the corner, because if they did, they'd be risking running into the back of NX Racing Red. So Virgil kind of boxed him out there.
So it looks like Glacier in the sixth currently, despite the fact they lost time letting the leader through. It looks like they Virgil were faster than him anyway, and Virgil now actually coming up to the leader to try and unlap themselves. I don't think that's going to work.
Yeah, I think that's a little bit too risky here. No, PJ actually. PJ's one of those people who goes to sleep, you know, on a good timely schedule. And because of this race, he's actually shifted his schedule a little bit. Went to sleep late last night, woke up late today, and plans on staying up pretty late into the night in order to help out his European teammates.
Fair path commitment for you.
Yep. I think also Simon Cattell for NX Racing Blue has done something similar. He's been going to sleep as late as 6 a.m. That's mainly... Actually, I think, yeah, all the Europeans are actually on NX Racing Blue. So that means that he's the person who's staying up all the way through the night to race.
I always get very emotional in 24 hours. I think I've done two or three 24-hour races, and it's like, I don't know, like middle of the night, you're like, ah. You're not quite there yet. You know, you want to be asleep and everything's going on. It's emotional stuff.
Yep.
If you want to see me cry, that's probably the best time to do it. Say something nasty to me about like 3 a.m. You'll get me. You'll get me.
You're going to sleep though by 3 a.m., aren't you?
Yeah. Also, I probably wouldn't cry in a comment like on air. Maybe I would.
Looks like Yanni's holding his ground pretty well here to Paul Ulbricht, just behind.
Looking very close now, Paul Ulbricht. I reckon we'll have a go into the bus stop. assuming you can get the slipstream of that 4GT, as we've said. Very quick in a straight line. So those two codes, IGP codes we gave away earlier, they've both been snapped up. So we'll be giving away another one in a little bit, so keep an eye out for that. We've got another 22 still to give away. We'll be giving some away on facebook.com/Masters of Endurance and on Twitter at Masters of Endu. And here, on this stream.
Oh, actually, gonna have to jump up here to be battled in third position. Was I saying this correctly? Yeah. Team Redline, Ali Pakala. Great pace, actually, this past stint. Catching GT Ross Silver.
Yeah, wherever they lost that time, they clearly got the pace. And yes, currently 0.8 faster on the last lap. So this, this will be a good battle. Because so far this race, we've really only seen Redline being passed because they were in the lead. And they were passed, and then they were second, and now they're third. But now it's time for them to go on the attack and have another go at it. Championship leaders, remember, 15 points.
Yeah, 15 points. They got pole this round as well, so that's another 5 points extended to 15. They actually haven't won a race this season, so leading the points, haven't won a race. Been doing a good job, though. Very consistent.
Yeah, it's been really impressive. But yeah, we could see him on the attack. I'd be interested to see how this battle works out with GT Ross. So it's right on board with Ollie Pakala as he comes down the hill into Bruchel. It looks like, I feel like that Pakala's got a more sort of consistent style at the moment than David Matter ahead. Matter's car looks a little bit squiggly sometimes.
Yeah,
but
I think
pretty quick though.
Yeah, the roof's currently 13 laps into a stint, and my personal experience, I mean, it could be wrong, it matters how you set up the car. But if you set the car up with a lower wing, I would say the lower half of the range, it seems like the car gets, you know, really nasty in the rear end about halfway through the stint to the end, all the way to the end. And I think it's just mainly because of the lower rear wing, you're putting a lot of pressure on the rear tires to perform. And I think it just, you know, weakens them. And some drivers can get away with that a lot better than others.
Yeah, and GT Ross ran a lot longer in their last stint, which is very interesting. They are, of the top nine, they pitted most recently. They have 13 laps on them, whereas the cars around them, the leader and third place, are both 20 laps into their stints.
Yeah, I also want to note that, I mean, you can see David actually ran 5 seconds slower that last lap. So something clearly happened last lap that we missed.
Mm.
I just realized that, yeah, they're 13 laps into their stint, so it wasn't a pit stop for sure. They wouldn't be in second if it was a pit stop. Yeah, back down to a 20.0 that last lap. Ollie may have the draft here, but they're running pretty close to the exact same time, so I don't think he'll be able to pass them. May be wrong, though. Huge run here up Kemmel Straight.
Yeah, off the left-hand side goes Bakalut round the outside. He gets it into the apex, impressively. Matter doesn't force the issue, and that is second place for Team Redline now. Good move.
Yeah, Ali's been driving great here for Team Redline already at this stint.
Masters of Endurance debut.
We say it as if like he's a rookie or something, but DWC driver, extremely talented.
Yeah, it's no surprise.
I always wonder, actually, Team Redline, how does that work? Because, you know, you have Gregor Hutu, obviously, who's, you know, multi-time DWC champion, good on both oval and road. And then you have someone like Enzo, who, once again, really good on the roadside for sure. And then he comes here in McLaren, and he just seems like he's outperforming his teammates. I don't know. Gregor's not hasn't been racing this. Gregor's been taking he takes well-deserved breaks over the winter, so I don't blame him for that. But I wonder if Enzo kind of cracks on him a little bit, saying like, "Hey guys, look, I'm faster than you," or something like that. Wouldn't be surprised to have him a little jokingly.
Yeah, a little bit of competitive banter always helps. Just about to pass 5 hour mark of this race, this Masters of Endurance 24-hour race. The eighth running of the Masters of Endurance 24 hours. It's the first MOE 24 hours in 2 years, though.
Our first in iRacing as well.
Indeed.
Oh, as you know, you were correct earlier. Coenda is actually lifting there. I don't know if they're actually able to gain an extra lap each time under pitting, but Klaus Kivikas was definitely lifting there before braking.
Interesting. Yeah, I mean, because that was Krunker earlier who I spotted, so if two drivers are doing it now, that means maybe they're trying to reshift their strategy after the incident earlier in the race.
And it's not like he's going slow either. He's definitely gaining time on the car ahead. It also could just be where he was in draft. He lifts a little bit early to where when he brakes, he's kind of at the same speed as what he would normally be at. Still saving fuel in the process, though.
Yeah. It's P9 at the moment, chasing Jason Lovett in the NX Racing Blue BMW.
Yeah, Kivikas, former DWC driver as well, for Coanda. Previously, was in my 3ID.
Oh, yeah, familiar name. 4 laps into their stint versus 20 for Jason Lovett, so you'd assume this is pretty slam dunk as they go into the bus stop, because he'll have way more traction on the way out.
Yep. I think Klaus is just going to set up here. Two BMWs, so we don't have to worry about too much straight line speed difference, just the draft. And maybe a wing setting or two. You saw how Klaus had to wait for Jason to get on the throttle there.
Yeah, I think he's been very patient.
I think he believes he can get him here on Kemmel Straight this time.
I wonder if he'll stay behind and coast a bit and save fuel again.
I think since Jason's so much slower on his older tires, that Klaus probably lost well over half a second.
Yeah,
that's a fair
point.
Yeah, he should have a good run here. Would be surprised if Jason fought against this. He's giving him the inside, that's for sure.
Yep, should be pretty easy. As long as he brakes nice and early. Yeah, he lifts off. In fact, yeah, that was a very polite of Jason. Always a gentlemanly driver.
Yeah, he actually
moves on to eighth.
the last 24-hour race, all I remember at the end of it was once the race was over, the first thing Jason did was pull off the track and start doing donuts because he was just happy to finish.
Yeah, I think everyone should. Yeah, I think donuts are a necessary celebration. It should be mandatory for all winners for boat sport to do donuts.
You can already see Klaus, those fresh tires, already pulled a huge gap. We see on board with Jason here as a car just in front of Coanda, actually.
Yeah, it's Hellenic Racing Team. That's Panoulas in P41. And the Hellenic Racing Team BMW just getting out the way.
Possibly damage on that car. Also, while this overtake was happening, we also had Muhammad S. Patel for Team Camaro to get around Team TTL's Matthew E. Hill.
Indeed, yeah, and in front of Patel is another battle for P27. Boris, there's a car off. Who is that? That is Simon Grossman of Trinity Motorsports. Was in P43. It's car number 60. Ran off the road at Stavelo, I think that was.
Yeah, it's pretty heavy damage there to the right side of the car.
Yeah, I'm just going to see what happens. Oh, there was, it was contact with car 112.
Oh, 112, that's, oh, I see that now, actually. That's GT Ross's orange car.
Yes.
They've dropped way back and they're pitting now.
Oh, so there's damage then, I guess.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, it was a double collision, yes. It was a double, like, he touched him and then as he spun, crashed into him again. So, yeah, there's damage on the left. That is very unfortunate because they were,
They just got past. Oh, wait, no, sorry. They were back to the sixth position.
Yeah. That was Enrique Lopez behind the wheel. Got a tweet from Bert Ekmans from Flux Racing Team, who's using the hashtag IRMOE. Good, decent stint from me, he said. Sebastian now in the car, taking it back to the top 25. 19 hours to go. Hashtag go. So yeah, he's enjoying this one.
Yep, and Sebastian has actually drove up to the 21st position.
Vortex Sim Racing have had another off.
That's their second car this time, yeah.
Justin Brunner in the 114 car just had a spin at the exit of Lacoon. I believe that was. No, not Lacoon, sorry. The one out the corner.
Well, it's Malmedy, but.
Yeah, Malmedy, yeah. That was a mistake of his own. Just nosed into the tyre barrier, not too much damage.
Let's see, who else do we have? Let's see, we have the 92 car in the battle with the car head, or 49. The CTC Racing and...
High revs. So that's Mark Pickford in the black BMW ahead of the blue BMW of Robert Podgorny. It's P45 and P46 this one. And the car ahead, the red BMW. It's MOE colours actually. Yeah, that's a car in P37. That's Andreas Schwarz in the All-Star Racing Team number 2, car 40. Oh, car ahead has just had a spin. Oh, crash! Andreas Schwarz flies into the air upside down. That was unfortunate. Mark Pickford also involved, and Ivan Brito of Rincon Racing.
Oh,
that
also
sounds
racing.
A little bit familiar.
Team Racing 2 is definitely flipped over there. I'll do a quick replay on that.
Yeah, let's have a look. So Rincon Racing loses it going into the left-hander. We're about to see that. He's the car at the front of your picture. This is a car that's been involved in several incidents today. They lose it, come back across the track and flip into Mark Pickford and Andreas Schwarz have nowhere to go, unfortunately. And that is the third major incident for that 93 car in this race. That is really unfortunate for those guys. And yeah, I imagine the 93 car will be looked at now because it has had somewhat
too many
incidents.
Yeah, that's his third major incident of the race.
I mean, this one was a mistake, and like it was nothing he could do once he was out of control. But on the other hand, if your car has two other major incidents, you have to dial it back a bit. So
exactly.
Yeah, that's not good.
Also, currently have a battle. The number 62 of Trinity Motorsports 3, I believe this is, and the number 10 of Iberica Racing Team.
Yep. So that's Kevin Pate, Trinity Motorsports BMW P17, and Ade Koba Lopez of Iberica in P18. Looking for a pass going into Lacoum, I would say. To the inside goes Lopez. And brakes later. Just slides his way in and passes to Kevin Pate, who I think that's his first stint of the race. I've not seen him before. This race, that is.
I think he did one stint prior to this, but yeah, he's been very quiet. Also, the car directly in front of Ibirica now, also for position as R4 on Motorsport.
Oh, yeah. So Ibirica are 13 laps into their stint. The car ahead is 23 laps into its stint, the R4R car of Joseph Mudrak. So you'd expect this Lopez to get past with his fresher tyres.
Yeah, he didn't waste any time there.
Nope, up the inside of Puan. Not bad.
As you can see now, Ibirica have 15 seconds until they reach the next car, which is Pure Racing Team 2, the number 9 McLaren. I'd like to jump back up also to Paul Ilbring, who's been following the Glacier Racing car for probably the past eight laps,
still
for sure.
Yeah. What about that?
And they haven't been able to pass it. It was down to 0.2 seconds, so they're right on the bumper at one point. But either the Ford is just really hard to pass due to the straight line speed, or Paul's just kind of riding and, you know, saving his fuel, saving his tires.
Just had a tweet go out from Masters of Endurance giving you the next code to use at IGP Manager, the supporter, the sponsors of MOE. One of the sports in the MOE, along with Derek Spear Designs in this race, Blue Flag Racing. So yeah, head to at Masters of Endu, look at that code, and then head to IGP and get that year of free 2D pack worth $50. We've got another 21 of those to give away. Race, should also mention we have a new sponsor, which is going to be GrandPrix247.com, who will be sponsoring the 6 hours of the Circuit of Americas. That's tentatively the 31st of January, 1600 yeah. UTC.
Yeah, they report of a lot of Formula One news and get a lot of winter testing news from them. They also are contributing to end of the season prize fund, so very gracious to them.
Yeah, that's along with the prizes given away by Derek Spear Design as well.
And IGP.
And IGP, so yeah, nice little hamper, sort of a mix of stuff. So next race of red are in the pit lane.
Ah, and they're switching between brothers now. So PJ was just in the car, now he's gotten out again. Or sorry, Jake was in the car previously, then PJ, now back to Jake. So their household is filled with endurance racing right now. It's cool to see.
Yeah, good. Both had extremely good and very clean stints so far in this race. And that's why they're in the lead.
Yeah, they've been doing a great job. Also want to note that Ollie for Team Redline, you'll see them in right now.
Oh, yep, just drives in front. Parks up behind the safety car.
Sooner or later, I think it has to happen. Paul Ilbring has to pass Jani Hagner here.
Yeah, unless he doesn't want to. That's the only reason I can imagine.
I think he's losing time, though. I think he could. I'm pretty sure Paul can go faster than that. Ford seems like it falls off a little bit. Assuming that's, you know, tire related more than anything. Oh, and then Hagner pits, which this is actually Paul's worst nightmare, really, because now Hagner's going to get even farther ahead.
He's going to come back and find him again after the next. Yeah. Oh dear. So at least he has some clean air for a bit. See him on upshot.
As you can see, there's quite a bit of ways now for Paul Ilbring to go before he reaches the next car. Actually, not that far. It's where's that? Actually, oh, Ollie Paco is coming out of the pits for Team Redline. Paul OSG Steel Sim Racing, and then you see Paco just ahead. Also want to note that NX Racing Blue's also made a pit stop. Jason Lovett out of the car. Jack Sedgwick in. Actually didn't even have enough drivers in NX Racing Blue and decided to grab Jack, throw him in the car.
He literally threw him in the car.
Yep.
Ouch.
Currently in a battle for position with R4R Motorsport. Which actually, they're on probably one, if not their last lap of the stint, maybe the next lap is their last, and, well, Jack for NX Racing Blue is on his first, so. One would say this is a massive holdup.
Yeah, there we go, easy peasy. Just had a tweet on the hashtag IRMOE. Danny Greaser just tweeted a picture of himself with his racing gloves, thumbs up. About to start another stint.
Ah, I believe that's for Quarter Motorsports.
It is, yeah. Ready for the night shift, he said.
Oh, actually. Better get ready to look in the rearview mirror. It's Klaus Kivikas for Coanda SimSport. Battle for position here.
It is, yeah. So Niels Koch currently driving the core car. And yeah, Kivikas now looking very racy indeed. Kivikas 10 laps into his stint, Core Motorsports 24 laps into his stint, so it should be fairly easy.
Yeah, that was a straightforward move there.
Yeah, Niels Koch didn't defend the issue, decided just to continue on his own race because, yeah, Coanda are not in sync at the moment.
Currently have a bunch of cars pitting and whatnot, so everything's getting a little confusing here. Paulo breaking down the pits for Radicals Online 2. Another battle on track here. We have battles everywhere right now. Last Lap Motorsports, number 52 car. Number 70 of Racemore, Kraut Racing. Both have just come out of the pits, so they've been battling basically through the pit stops and now on their outlaps.
I think that's Richard Holliday's first stint of the race. I believe. I'm normally wrong.
I've seen him spotting for that team. I don't think he's been driving. So yeah, this definitely is his first stint for them.
So that's the red roof behind this black, white, red and blue BMW, the Racemore Kraut Racing team, of, and the car currently being driven by Stefan Ullmann. It's P29 and P30 this battle, but I'm sure they'll rise up the order once everyone else pits. But who will be ahead? I think Richard Holliday has got a good run out of the bus stop, and can he go for the outside? Yes. Can he do the outside move? He'll break later.
Yeah, they also have Jake Sturgis and NX Racing Red just behind them. So he's hoping nothing happens.
Yeah, Richard Holliday is going to should be ahead by the time they get to Eau Rouge. Yeah, I think he's got it. He completes the pass as they turn in. Stefan Ullmann gets a little bit wobbly on the way in, but gets away with it. And,
I think that
yeah.
would probably be the worst place to get wobbly. Honestly, that's terrifying.
Yeah, we saw Vortex do that earlier. Got wobbly and wobbled on the way upside down into the tyre wall. And Jake Sturgis goes past the Liquimoli liveried Racemore Kraut Racing car. Currently P2, but will be P1 once David Massa pits in a few laps time.
I'm about to tell you some news that you may not enjoy. Actually, it's not terrible news. So I believe that you remember the Glacier car pit, and also Radicals Online just pit, Radicals Online 2. And as they were exiting the pits, Glacier had a huge run down Kemmel Street and passed them right back.
Aha! The battle continues.
Yes, both Riku and Paul, I believe still both DWC drivers. If not, they have raced in DWC before. Great drivers, both of them.
Yeah, I think this is Riku's first stint, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
So he should be fresh, whereas Paul Ilbrink is in his third or fourth stint so far this race.
Yeah, both actually Endurance racing hasn't been around long, and iRacing, however, both of them well equipped for endurance racing. Both have pretty good stamina from what we've all seen with Neo and other series. 2.4 hour races and whatnot, they've competed in them quite often.
Bit of a interesting that Paul Ilbrink decides to use the brakes on his way through these fast corners of Blanchimont. He had a couple of dabs, possibly because the tyres are still cold and he just wants a bit of confidence in his first outlap.
Yeah, that is actually pretty interesting how that works. I'm not sure if it's trying to keep the car stable or what. I can understand, like, you know, you tap and just ride the brakes a little bit before the corner, you know, keep the tires nice and heated and slow the car down that way. But Blanchimont's one of those ones you need a well-balanced car. You don't want that car to snap on you in that corner. Definitely don't want that. Because it's very rare that you can lose control of the car and not hit anything.
Yeah, these cars are pretty snappy. Once you've lost it, you're going into a wall one way or another.
Exactly.
So, after 18... No, not after 18 hours. With just 18 hours and 40 minutes to go in this 24-hour race at Spa-Francorchamps, Masters of Endurance. The leader is currently David Matter for the GT Ross SST Silver, but when they pit in the next 10 minutes or so, that lead will be handed back to NX Racing Red and Jake Sturgis. Team Redline are currently in third, fourth Coanda SimSport, fifth Virgil Racing, sixth Core Motorsport, seventh AB Racing Black, eighth Glacier Racing, Radicals Online 2 in 9th, and Iberica Racing Team in 10th. They've recovered after their drive-through, up to 10th.
Yeah, also, shout-out to AB Racing Black, number 75 car. They're in 7th position currently. I don't actually remember them being anywhere close to 7th position the last time I checked, so...
They are coming to the end of a stint, but yes, I've not seen much in this... race either, so by the time they pit they'll probably drop to around, I think, 19th, I'm going to say.
Yeah, they're going to be pretty far back. Also, Core Motorsports pitting as well.
Yeah, that's who's going to, have they got another driver going in? Oh yeah, Danny Guso, of course, yes, he sent that tweet moments ago. He's got his racing gloves on, he's ready to go. His last stint, he had a collision with Glacier Racing, so hopefully he'll try not to repeat that.
You saw Virgil Racing just exiting the pits now. Both Core Motorsports and Virgil have been pretty much on the same stint strategy so far. They joined the track right in the pack of cars, including the leader just passed.
Yeah, that's Jake Sturgis just lapping Trinity Motorsports 3, Kevin Pate.
Sorry, I said leader. That's provisional net leader,
yes.
However you want to explain it, as the number 113 of GT Ross Silver. Have not pit yet. I don't know why I like to pronounce that team name a little weird. Ross. GT Ross.
Well, we pronounce everything else weird, so we might as well pronounce that weird as well.
Exactly. It's an American thing, to be honest. It really is.
Looking...
Just wait for the night stint. We'll have two Americans on here commentating.
Oh, goodness. Richard Hallway is going around the outside of the Trinity car. Kevin Pate letting him through. Why is that? Is that because they're on different strategies?
I'm pretty sure they both exited the pit at the same time. We were looking at that earlier.
Yeah, you're right. I don't know why he let him last lap motorsport through. I think they're... Yeah, they pitted it around the same time, yeah, so I don't know why he let him through so easily, but there we go. Behind that is Virgil Racing, who are a lap or so ahead, two laps ahead.
Oh, we saw a little gaggle there for a split second. Hammond Durant's team just went into the pits, allowing both Pure Racing team cars to go by.
Two of the three.
A little pitcher moment there for them.
Yeah, they're 19th and 20th at the moment.
Yeah, also, you can see in the background, car not having... Wait, actually, I must be blind. I can't even see him on the position list right now. You see, actually, all Pure Racing team cars right there in a line.
Yeah, that is Pure Racing. They're the only team with, I think, three cars in the race, and yet they're two McLarens and one BMW. They are currently 19th, 20th, and 40th.
Yeah, the BMW's a little bit damaged there. We have All-Star Racing as well. All-Star Racing team had three cars in. These are the only two teams, I believe, with three cars competing currently today.
Just a reminder, if you aren't watching this on the Masters of Endurance website, you should be, because on the live streaming page at mastersofendurance.net/live, you get an IRC chat and also a live timing table which updates continuously and tells you how many stints, how many laps on the stint the driver has done and how many pit stops they've done as well. It gives you their lap times and the gaps and the drivers on board as well. So yeah, it's a great little feature, so you should be enhancing your experience with mastersofendurance.net/live.
And also all those essential little links up there, Facebook, Twitter, obviously the website and different other little things you can look at. Entry list as well.
Yeah, keep an eye on facebook.com/mastersofendurance and twitter.com/mastersofendu, where we'll be posting updates for the race and also codes for IGP Manager.
I see Mad Cow Racing here on stream. Just look like they just got a slowdown. I believe, actually, I don't know about Craig Spark. Yeah, he's Australian. So, unfortunately for him, he just got a slowdown, whether if it was warranted or not.
Yeah, P15, pretty good. Pretty good for them, but maybe that high up so far this season.
Also have another battle, three-way battle for position right now for 35th position. It's Team Camaro 1 car. Then you have Trinity Motorsports, then New World Sim Sports Scarlet.
And that is... I'm just trying to find them on my list of cars. Yeah, it's the black McLaren, that's the Team Camaro car. Followed by Simon Grossman from the Trinity Motorsports BMW. And yeah, behind them is John Hall in the MWSS Scarlet McLaren. Really like that car.
Yeah,
that colour really goes.
The BMW is actually on the later part of their stint, while John Hall has the freshest tires, and then Team Camaro is about 7 laps into their stint. So, you know, a little diversity here. Actually surprised that the Trinity Motorsports car is able to keep up with that damage and also those older tires.
Yeah, although it looks like he's lifted off a bit too late.
Yeah, I say that now.
Didn't make it obvious he was going to do that though, so I think Paul was taken a little bit by surprise. Paul much faster through Blanchimont, I would say, compared to Adam Parley, who is just turning into the bus stop now. Adam Palm, in fact, not Palm. I'm told.
Just want to note that the GT Roush Silver team, whoa, we saw John Hall right on the bumper there of Team Camaro's car.
Yeah, that's weird. They didn't actually happen on my screen. They happened on the screen, didn't happen where I was looking. Weird.
But the GT Roush Silver car has went in and made a pit stop, come out of the pits. They're actually in fourth position now. Coanda currently in third. They have to make one more pit stop to even out with the cars ahead of them.
So Inex Racing Red's lead is 44.5 seconds, 136 laps down. We're nearly a third of the way, no, a quarter of the way through the race. Half an hour until we're a quarter way through the race.
Yeah, that's good. I like to be a quarter way through the race. Makes me feel happy. It's essentially four races in one, if you really think about it, if you block it off into six-hour formats. And unfortunately, for some people out there, we did not do a 12-hour, or like 6 hours, and then 12 hours a night, and then 6 hours a day at the end. It's just too much to ask for.
All running wise, and Paul, John Hall now has an opportunity, heading into the right and left-handers at Fannier and then Stavolo.
John Hall, definitely, most people probably know John Hall, currently posts a lot of videos on iRacing Forum, trying to help out different people, helping them prep for the races, posting a lot of setups and stuff. Very good guy for the iRacing community, to be honest.
Yeah, that's what you want. So, you know, one thing being fast, but also, you know, getting involved with the community, because community is really important with this kind of thing. If you haven't got a community, you haven't got a, you haven't got a game, basically.
Exactly. We're currently on board with them now.
So I think Oscar Hardwick, who was commentating earlier, he went off to do, I think, the
it's like a touring car?
I think it was the BSR TV British Touring Car event. Oh, it was the... Oh, no, it's not. It's an R-Factor BTCC, in fact. R-Factor 2 British Touring Car Championship. It's a three-race event, and he's won the first two races. And he's currently in third for the next one. So that is a fair play. Nice one, Oscar. Congrats. When he comes back, I'm sure he'll be tired.
If he doesn't win the third one, I'm going to come back. When he comes back, I'm going to tell him I'm very disappointed in him. Got to have the hat trick.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, if you're going to do two, you've got to do the three. So we're being told that actually every time Oscar leaves the commentary booth to go do an R-Factor race, he always ends up winning. Now, John Hall just had to pull off there.
That's a slowdown.
He's got a slowdown, yeah. He did cut Eau Rouge. He cut Radion pretty badly, so I think that explains that.
Yeah, we saw that on stream there. I would say in his defense, but not really. He's American. It's an American server, so we don't have excuses. If we get a slowdown, it's most likely warranted. I have to report it again. Paul Obrink. Still about a half second behind Riku Alatalo. I actually don't even know how to say it. PSRTV pronounced his name rather incorrectly in one of their streams, and I don't even know how it is. Atulo maybe? Something like that, instead of Alatalo.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So, he always goes by that nickname. However, we're going to call him by the correct name. Oh, we're actually being told there's a YouTube video with all the clips of them pronouncing it wrong. Holy cow.
Oh, that sounds like fun. Oh, dear. I'm glad
if we get bored later at like 2 or 3 in the morning, maybe we'll watch that. Give us a good laugh, wake us up.
Yeah. I'm glad no one ever made a compilation of my foul-ups over the years with pronunciation. Because I was commentating Olympus Food from like 2008 to 2011, I think. And lots of drivers and lots of difficult names.
It's always the Polish names that were fun. See Riku there going a little wide. Yeah, you see Paul there, he had to lift. Riku did not. Well, at least not as much. Paul playing it safe with the off tracks.
Yep, up ahead of them, there's a whole bunch of cars. They are to be lapped. The first one is Robert Podgorny of High Res Racing in P47. Then there's a battle between Stefan Ullmann in P22 and Kevin Pape for Trinity Motorsports in P23. but they've not quite reached them yet.
Yes, I thought it was actually quite humorous that Paul slowed down for Blanchimont, you know, took it easy, and then by the next corner they were bumper to bumper again. As Riku had lap cars in front, who, oof, trying to give him the position, but Riku wanted that draft.
Yeah, he made the most of that.
Very nice move there, made sure Paul could get by as well. I'm sure the Blue Flag Racing guys who are watching right now are really happy to see that.
Yep, everyone paying attention to blue flags. Although they're on, are they blue flags?
Yeah, they're blue flags.
Yeah,
it's just very generic, but yeah, there's blue flags.
You can tell it's been a while since I raced.
Yeah, I believe it's 1.5 seconds, and then you are notified of it.
Lead gap, 46.5 seconds in X Racing Red over Team Redline. And then Coanda SimSport a further 13.5 seconds behind.
Yeah, just going to look at that real fast. Pretty interesting. Coanda's done a good job. They have to pit soon, I believe.
Yeah, currently actually, on 19 laps. Yeah, they've got a little while to go.
But good to see them slowly bringing their way back into this. Really good to see.
Yeah, I wouldn't count on that winning, to be honest. Because they've recovered, it's been about 3 hours or so since their accident. And they're already back up into third, so I wouldn't put it past them being in contention for the win at the end of this.
And you see, they're only 14 seconds behind Team Redline. Which really, I mean, I was thinking at Redline and Coanda, that those would have been the two strongest ones for the championship. And it really has been so far, except for Suzuka, where Coanda had their issues with the lap car and Redline.
Woo!
Ollie! Amazing.
Wow. Wow.
And that's the only time you're going to see that, guys. That is the only time you're going to see that.
We've got to get a replay of that, surely.
Wow. We should.
That was amazing. So this is it. So this is coming out of Blanchimont.
We're going to go on board here?
Yes. Riding his own business. I'm guessing he lifts off a little or something. Oh,
he clipped the curb a little wrong there.
That is incredible.
Look at that. Those hands. Wow.
That was the second place car in this race for anyone who's just joined us. Showing off a bit.
Now, remember we were talking about donuts. That doesn't fit in. Doesn't fit in there at all.
Premature donuts.
Yeah. He can celebrate now that he's alive after that. Oof. That was a close one. And enough talking about them now, because I am not going to jinx anybody. We're just going to go back to the, it's like 3 hours now, it feels like, they've been in battle.
It's never ending. They're going to be like in 18 hours time, they'll still be together, I think.
It's good to see, though. I mean, some were saying that the roof is probably the fastest car this race, and, you know, everyone thinks the Ford's the slowest car, yet they're battling for position right now, the sixth position.
Yeah. Yeah, Bam's performance is looking pretty good this race.
So, sorry about that. Another battle, but I think it may have just ended. I'm not sure. Oh no, actually, Iberica Racing Team are about to pit very soon. NX Racing Blue less than halfway through their stint. Wow, Jack's showing some muscle there around the outside.
Give you a run on the top 15. Now we'll be Yeah, now we're looking pretty, everyone looking pretty stable. So yeah, Innix Racing Red lead, Team Red Line in second, Commander Sim Sport third, GT Ross Silver in fourth, fifth Gogo Racing, sixth Gracie Racing, seventh Radicals Online 2, 8th Ball Motorsports, 9th Innix Racing Blue, 10th Iberica Racing Team, 11th Team Chimera 2, 12th Team CTL, 13th JCL Sim Racing, 14th Mad Cow Racing 2, and running up the top 15 is... oh, it's just changed, brilliant. Oh, because Mad Cow just pitted and we're moving out the names. Thanks, Mad Cow. So 14th is Pure Racing 2 and 15th is Pure Racing 1. There you go.
Yeah, just starting to hit the, I wouldn't say heavier part of the night for the Europeans, but the real... real nighttime.
Yep.
So this is when it all starts kind of happening. Not just yet. I would probably say another 3 hours or so. We'll see where people start getting tired and whatnot. And then it's about a 6 hour span. So from 15 hours to go all the way to probably 6 to 8 hours left. We'll see. We'll see some tired people. Just for you guys out there, I have found another little battle on track. They're side by side right now. Three car and the number 62.
Yeah, it's Trinity Motorsports on the outside, Kevin Pate versus All-Star Racing 2-1, Robert Bergnauer. And that was a battle for P22. I think Bergenauer took that position over the line and then completed it into the first hairpin. They're roughly on the same strategy, 7 laps into their stint. In fact, oh, well, it looks like Trinity Motorsports coming back as they go down the Kemmel Straight. Leku awaits, who will break first? I think Kevin just got that one, yeah. Secures it, but I'm sure Bergnauer will not lie back and take it, and will try and fight back.
Yeah, Trinity Motorsports 3 here, they've... Remember earlier they had a nice little quick 360 when seeing them before. You also see Core Motorsports in the background there, in 8th position, trying to find their way through this hot traffic. It's funny, actually, we were going into the season and we thought about having multi-class racing, and then NEO put out their schedule and we saw that, you know, they were going the multi-class route. And we weren't actually upset with that, because then we were like, well, no one's doing GT3, so let's try that. And having 60 cars on track, we weren't going to do that at first, but then we were like, you know, why not? You don't really see that in sim racing, where you have 60 competitive cars, you know, racing against each other in one class. So, you know, we thought, let's try it and see what happens. And so far it's been pretty good. You have, you know, cars battling against each other, even though they're 2 or 3 laps down, or some of them only 1 lap down. And then you have also, you know, other cars lapping and everything, but it's very respectful in a sense of, you know, it's not multiple classes. You don't have an HPD passing, you know, a roof cup car or, you know, for GT2. So it's been pretty good so far. Quite enjoyed, actually.
Yeah, and the quality of the field as well has been really good. We've only seen sort of in this race, we've seen a few incidents that may have been a bit questionable, but from, you know, the vast, vast majority of the teams here have done a really stand-up job, and they've practiced a lot. And you can tell that by how close they are in qualifying as well, the gap between them. As Danny Gusser now trying to lap that Trinity Motorsports car and does so successfully. But that means the All-Star Racing team of Robert Bergnauer now has an opportunity to repass Kevin Pape in that BMW, and will use the slipstream down the straight.
We saw a little bit of respect I was talking about there. You saw the number 3 of the All-Star Sim Racing car just kind of tap the brakes and let the 62 in. That, you know, that's just courtesy, basically. I mean, obviously now he's going to be able to pass him.
Yeah.
But you know, before that. It's just, you know, being nice, saying, hey, I'll let you get back in here. Of course, I'll pass you in the next corner.
Behind them, the Sofa, aka the Slow Finns, are battling with Hybrid Racing for P46, and Antti Tuominen just passed for P46. That's Robert Pagani in the blue BMW for Hybrid Racing, down to P47.
It's once again another battle. one lap down from the battle right in front of them, but yeah, they're having a nice little race as well.
Yeah, Kevin Pake just was passed at Lake Hume, but he's not fallen back. These two have really got pretty even pace, Kevin Pake and Robert Bergnau.
Yeah, some drivers just like that. Or some, you know, it's just situations where, it just like this between Radicals Online 2 and Glacier, it's almost actually, it's been Paul Obrink the whole time. Paul Obrink and Glacier Racing. They've been extremely just stuck together like glue, basically, for most of this race.
Yeah, he's falling back a little bit. I think he's just taking it easy at this point. Well, as easy as one can when driving at 158 miles an hour. So we're looking at Kalanda SimSport still sitting in P3. They are 6 seconds ahead of GT Ross SST Silver. Kalanda is Kivikes currently driving 23 laps into his stint. And as he heads into the first corner. Still remember how fortunate they were to still be in this race after a T-bone collision about 3 hours ago. Interesting to see how the GT Ross SST Silver car does, 7.5 seconds behind, with Antonio Madrid currently behind the wheel. Joining us in the commentary box is team principal of Redline Racing, Dom Duan. Hi, Dom.
Hello there. How's it going?
Yeah, pretty good. How's your race going? You're P2 right now, and it's been a pretty exciting one so far, hasn't it?
Yeah, I think it's exciting. Obviously, we've got the beast known as Enzo, who just is a bit of a terminator when it comes to laying down some insane lap times. And we've got a couple of new drivers that joined us recently, Holly and Alexi. Both were kind of awesome in DWC last year. And certainly, they kind of jumped in to assist in what is our first ever kind of endurance series. So, yeah, I think we're doing all right.
Yeah, indeed. And I mean, so you had Enzo in for the first stint. I take it that's because of like raw pace to get away from everyone in the first laps, I would guess.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it goes for, I think, for all the races. Enzo kind of leads the way as kind of the lead driver in the GT. I mean, he won the iRacing GT series last year as well, so he's got a bit of pedigree and certainly can put down the lap straight away. And, you know, we definitely think that there's some issues with the McLaren at the moment in terms of kind of out-and-out race pace and kind of grip and feel and everything. But I think we're doing the best that we can with it, so pretty pleased with where we are at the moment.
Yeah, indeed, and still leading the championship, which is pretty good. I was just trying to work out, earlier in the race, maybe an hour or so ago, you guys lost a it would look like you lost a fair amount of time, but we never worked out why. Do you know what happened? We saw the collision with
I'm not sure.
Three.
I think it must have been repairing damage. We're not sure. Coming out the pits, I think we must have lost 15 seconds or so. I'm not quite sure. So, I'm sure Enzo will relish trying to get that back. we did lose a bit of time. But for us, this is, this is the first endurance series we've been in, and this is the first 24-hour race we've been in. So there's lots of firsts here, lots of learnings. We're not as kind of concerned about winning the entire event as much as kind of getting a strong result and a bit of experience under a belt.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically so many points available. Just scoring a decent top 10 finish, we sort of keep the championship yarns ticking over. And I guess, I mean, were you expecting when you came into the series to be, two races challenging for the lead of the championship or in the lead of the championship?
Well, I mean, in truth, I don't think we knew where we were going to be, with the differences between the cars and all of that. We thought we'd be competitive, certainly, because Enzo obviously won the GT series previously in the McLaren, and certainly he had a lot of experience in it, thought it was kind of one of the most balanced cars. But from the first race, we saw that the BMW was pretty strong in race pace, at least at kind of conserving fuel over the McLaren. But that was a really exciting race, and that kind of really got us excited for the future races, certainly, because I think we only finished like 9 seconds behind after a 12-hour race, and it was intense.
You're playing spotter for this one, aren't you?
Just watching the broadcast, admiring you guys doing a great job there, and relaying some information here and there, and admiring Ollie's 360s that he does at Blanchimont.
Oh God!
I was going to ask about that actually. How did you feel about that when you saw that?
Well, I think I was most surprised that the stream is actually live. I was watching it whilst talking to him about, I don't know, he's talking some random stuff as usual, but you know what, it was good that he hung on to that. And
Did he say anything in TeamSpeak when that happened?
Yeah, he just said he wanted to warm up his tyres in a very Kimi Raikkonen type voice, so who knows, he's finished, that's what they do. But yeah, he did, and I think he had his arm out the window in his house waving to the fans as he did it. But this is Ollie's first race representing us, so he's doing a great job. So. But a long way to go. We've 6 hours in. So.
Yeah, so it's only one complete race so far, really. We've got three more races to go.
Yeah, no, absolutely great. And this is 24 hours, the longest by far that we're usually in DWC, we usually do kind of F1 races, which are kind of sprint races compared to this, but we're driving with the same intensity as we do in DWC. Certainly fuel saving is something that we usually don't worry about, but that we've got to think about, but tyre conservation doesn't mean anything at the moment.
Looks like most of the time when you guys get in the car, you just go straight on. You kind of what I thought in the 12-hour race is you guys were just going for pure pace the entire time and not really worried about fuel or tires or anything like that. And I almost want to say it kind of bit you guys because Coenda had one less stop, even though it was only a 9-second gap for the win. But it seems like you guys have been playing the strategy game a little bit more now, which is cool to see.
Certainly that was our first ever endurance race, would you believe? We've been going for like nearly 15 years. And that's the first one we've done, so we just went out and we treated it as a kind of F1 type race. We're just going for pace, and you're right, it did bite us, and that's something we've learned, we hope, and now we have an Excel spreadsheet that does things, which is brilliant.
Oh, I love a good Excel spreadsheet.
Yeah, you couldn't beat this one as well. It's pretty impressive.
Are you going to be up for the whole 24 hours, or are you going to take a break at some point?
No, I certainly won't. But we have Enzo doing the night shift, and that would be interesting, because I know he's looking forward to getting back in the car. So there'll be quite a few hours done there, and maybe we can start to make some inroads into the Ionex guys, who are doing a great job. But I do think one of the biggest challenges is going to be the GT Ross Silver guys, just their kind of fuel consumption and just where we're pitting in relation to them. So I think if we get kind of top five, I wouldn't be really happy with that, in truth.
Cool. Well, are there any website sponsors, whatever you want to give a shout out to?
Yeah, that would be awesome. So our long-standing kind of partner, Fanatic, supply all of our kit. Absolutely fantastic, and especially the CSW wheel is just the best wheel that I've ever driven with, certainly. Guys, great job. SimRace TV, not RaceBot TV, as Dylan said earlier, which I found highly entertaining. Great job.
Well, thank you very much, and best of luck for the rest of the race. And,
cheers.
Yeah, have a good one. That's Dom Duin from Redline Racing, team principal, with his Excel spreadsheets. Currently watching his driver in second position, Ollie Pakula, as we head up towards. Oh, had a bit of a moment there, actually.
Yeah, why is he doing that? Scaring us like that.
He obviously enjoyed the interview, I guess.
Also, want to note that Klaus Kivikas in the car now for Coando. I believe he was. Or did they just... I believe he was still driving. Never mind. Sorry about that. Coming out in the 8th position. Just completed a pit stop. Notice now that they've pit and it's 6 minutes from the hour. So they're pretty close to, you know, reaching back on that hour mark again. However, I believe that most teams are already doing an hour, 3-minute stints and whatnot. So they're still playing catch up to that.
Yeah. But yeah, by the time I wake up tomorrow morning, they'll be back in sync.
Yeah, but even if they're not in sync completely, I think they're going to be far enough ahead to where when they do make that, you know, 30-minute splash and dash or whatever it is at the end of the race, that it won't be something that's terrible for them. As in, they'll have a big enough gap to the car behind to where once they pit, they don't either lose a position or at least not a lot.
Yeah. In about 4 or so minutes, we're going to briefly cut the stream. It should restart automatically, so you don't have to do anything. If it doesn't, just refresh the page and it will be back. We like to cut the stream up into manageable size chunks to put it on YouTube. I think that's youtube.com/ Masters of Endurance, where you can watch the entire race again, basically. We're uploading each section as it goes, so you can already watch the first part of the race if you so desire. If you want to watch the start, for instance. So we're about to briefly pause the stream now, so look out for that. I'm Michael Passing. I'm just going to be signing off for now. I'm going to leave you in the capable hands of Phil Diaz, whose voice you've already heard, and Jonathan Palmer will be joining you after the short break. So thank you very much for watching, and we'll be back in a moment for the final 18 hours of this 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing.